Why do counties matter? Simple. Counties provide the services we all depend on. If you're concerned about crime, get a regular flu shot, drive to work, take public transportation, or experience a natural disaster in your community, chances are you benefit from county services. That's why counties matter. With America's system of federalism, counties are a key level of government, serving the people directly. So, do you vote? Had a recent hospital stay? Know someone in a nursing home? More reasons why counties matter. There are 3,069 counties across the country, with populations big and small. Most of us live and work in one. Even the nation's capital is considered a county. These county governments ensure that the food you eat in restaurants is safe. They care for the mentally ill, run court systems, build local economies, and operate 911 emergency systems. They manage parks and recreation facilities, and the list goes on. Thing is, counties serve the American people in so many ways, keeping our communities healthy, vibrant, safe, and fiscally sound. That's why counties matter.
Everything starts out small. The things that hurt us, they all start from somewhere. The words we say, the things we do, that can grow into something else. What was small and innocent can become big and sometimes scary. All it takes is one comment, one picture, one video for something to catch fire. But a big problem doesn't need a big response. Not at first. Even if we don't know what to say, the eye emoji can be that first step we take. Let's all pledge to take that first small step together and change the world in a big way. I'm a witness, and so are you.
If yours is the next big idea, and you need the right place to fine-tune it, build it, launch it, if you're only your best when you can play more than you work, if inspiration comes from the outside, you belong in Curry County. The westernmost point of the land you love, and the edge between familiar and uncharted. Break the pattern. Be where the airports are as close as the beaches, and industry and recreation never cease to amaze. Dock, dive, and dine in a single day, and never lose your connection. This is the threshold of the West. Live where you can do you, and do it well, at the farthest point from ordinary. Curry County, living on the edge.
There's a shelter pet who wants to meet you. Meet one today. Visit theshelterpetproject.org. Adopt.
Thank you. One of the things I really appreciate about our entire region is that we embrace who we are, and I think that's what unifies us. Once the timber and fishing industries collapsed, it took us a long time to get back on our feet. People didn't quite grasp the idea that once these jobs left, they weren't going to get other family wage jobs, and it crippled us.
Things were getting really dire. So we just saw that this was an opportunity to maybe look at that public land a little differently and how it could bring more dollars into our region.
The Wild Rivers Coast is so unique because there are more wild and scenic rivers here than anywhere else in the lower 48 states. The scenic beauty is just amazing. There's so many different places to go, from the national forest down to the protected ocean, and it's just a really special place.
I guess I didn't really know how special it was, though, until I moved away to Portland and came back and saw all the potential here.
We're uncrowded, we're unspoiled, and we're a little difficult to get to, but my God, once you come here, you fall in love.
We just thought if we could pull people to come into this Wild Rivers Coast and stay longer and explore a little farther into our backcountry, there was a lot of opportunities for them to experience.
I think our whole future is at stake here. This area is ready to go. We just need to give it a little kick in the butt.
I'm going to be honest. When the Rural Tourism Studio came here, I was skeptical because I didn't see far enough ahead that we actually could collaborate regionally. And I'm pleasantly surprised. It's been amazing.
The Rural Tourism Studios was the first time we were able to come together as a region to talk about the future of our economy.
If we can have a strong tourism economy in this area, it's going to benefit the whole community.
We have to rely on ourselves, and I think through this program, it sort of opened our eyes to what we could do when we work together. Community leaders really focused on three areas: outdoor recreation, food and agricultural tourism, and really building community relationships.
In our area, a lot of the food that's grown all gets shipped away. And so now we're realizing that we can capture some of that local food that's grown here. The Eat Fresh and Local Action Team has hosted a series of networking events bringing together the area growers with the area vendors so that we could have more local food available to the visitors to our area. And now we're seeing more local food in our grocery stores, in our restaurants, and we have a new local food co-op.
We created a farm trail from Bandon to Port Orford. We did 9 U-Pick farms, and it just gained traction, and people loved it.
Langlois is less than 500 people. It's very small. So we have to bring in tourists. And being on the farm trail, even though it's just beginning, has really helped do that. We really want to make it a destination for anybody. My mom and I began Dragonfly Farm just 3 years ago. When I found out that I could grow a seed and turn that into food, it was like, oh my gosh, why wouldn't you do this? I just quit my day job and I just signed the paper to be an official co-owner of the farm. This is what I want to do for the rest of my life and grow with the community.
Out of the Outdoor Recreation Action Team, we came up with a series of maps that show where the best places to go recreate are. We know where we're gonna send people now, and we got a great map that shows all the best places to go see.
For us to get a mapping project done to this extent is pretty impressive. We're patting ourselves on the back. I don't know anybody else is, but we're doing it.
From that, we decided that there was some places that needed help. So we came up with a mountain bike plan, and we also worked on designating a state scenic bikeway. The Outdoor Recreation Action Team was also looking at how we can make scuba diving better in this area. So we came up with the idea for a scuba fill station. So now people that want to come and dive in this area, they can dive for multiple days because they can get their tanks filled up again. When I started the Rural Tourism Studio, my business, South Coast Tours, was really small. And now we've grown to about 5 or 6 guides, and we're doing tours all over from Brookings all the way up to Coos Bay.
Overall, tourism is on the rise here. We've had a bang up last 2 years, and it's like a breath of fresh air down here.
My hope for the area is that we still keep that sense of place.
Loving a place to death is a big concern that I have, and it's a balance. We're going to promote tourism, but we want to do it in a sustainable way. One of the biggest reasons that this area has been so successful since the tourism studio is the people that are involved. We have a lot of great, motivated, smart people who understand the need to promote tourism in the right way, and it's really all about the people.
When you live in a rural community like we do, from Bandon down to Brookings, and you're strapped for cash, relationships are crucial.
As a community, I think you need to come together and find out what your mission and goals are collectively. Then you can work into smaller groups, knowing that you have the backing of the whole community behind you.
As long as everybody's just super excited about it and passionate about what they're doing, and they can work together, then anything's possible.
Own what you have and don't try to be something that you're not. It's gonna be hard. It's gonna take a long time. So roll up your sleeves and just dig in with an open mind.
How many letters?
Five letters.
Just think about what am I doing right now?
Smile. Smile?
Uh-huh.
Oh, this is so easy.
Fire, as everyone knows, has emerged as one of the big major issues affecting Oregon and, for that matter, all western states. A real actionable response that's including how do we fight fire, actively managing our forests so that we don't have the fuels.
There it is, open. Okay. Welcome, everybody. We're going to call to order and stand for the pledge, and I'll invite everybody to join with me in just a short prayer. Just a second, we got a malfunction here. Technical difficulties. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this morning, chance to gather and do the business of Curry County. We're short a commissioner this morning who is in the hospital, so we pray for our fellow commissioner, Chris Pash, and his wife, Bonnie, who's visiting right now. I just got a text that not feeling at all well today, so we just lift that prayer up to you and to pray for healing, encouragement, comfort, and give the doctors wisdom, and just that he would be able to make the next meeting. So we do have business to take care of, and we offer it up to you. We thank you for this opportunity, and we just pray for your blessing on Curry County. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Join as we do the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good morning.
What's that? Appendicitis?
He's been in the hospital a week.
Yeah. Yeah. I can tell you more. Oh, yeah, it burst and, yeah.
Before he got to the hospital?
Yeah.
Yeah. Before he got to the hospital, it burst.
So welcome, everybody. Again, we are going to amend slash approval of the agenda. And as I mentioned earlier, we're minus a commissioner. It feels odd up here. Just one person gone. But so I have had a lot of input on this, especially since, you know, because I tried to call Chris this morning and he just said, I'm not calling in. I'm not going to be here. I'm not well and not at all well. So you know, we have some big stuff that we on the discussion action items, and I would, if court is in agreement, I think they should wait for all three of us to be here. And that those three things would be, we could talk about the D Roadmaster authority to purchase the skid steer, but the dump truck for $677,000. And the belly dump trailers for $580,000. I think all three of us need to be here. Those are huge expenditures, and I think all three of us. Rich has got his hand up. Would like to speak to that, but
can we at least discuss how the process we got there and what we did to achieve this, and just talk about it?
We don't have to make a decision.
Start the conversation because,
no, let's just let him talk later. Yeah, we'll make sure you get to come up. Is that okay?
Yeah, but I think we'll
we're
take
on
those
agenda amendments now.
Yeah, we'll amend those and we'll take those off the agenda for it would be my recommendation right now if you're in agreement.
What I'd like to do, yes, Mr. Chair, essentially I'm in agreement. I would like, as you mentioned, talk about 5D, but I'm in total totally unified with you there on the two bigger items. Without Commissioner Pash being here, I'd be much more comfortable just to delay that till he can attend or at least call in. I would like to hear from Roadmaster Christensen today, though, as he requested, and I think that would be very appropriate. So yeah. That's my position on that portion of the possible agenda amendments.
Okay. Yeah, and you can speak to that on the other items, but we'll remove F and E and F from the agenda.
No. Did you say E?
E and
Excuse
F.
me, I thought you said D. My apologies.
No, E and F. So I'll look for a motion to approve the agenda as amended.
I've got a couple other things here.
Pardon me?
I have one I'd like to add.
Okay,
well.
Yeah. Sorry, Anthony.
I have an IGA with Portland State University for a salary study. I'd like to add to discussion and action items.
So HIJ?
Yep.
And you said it's a...
It's an intergovernment agreement with Portland State.
Okay.
For the salary study.
Mr. Chair, I will have some comments on that, so I support okay. that addition.
Okay. So, any other amendments?
Under other, Mr. Chair, if I may.
Under other?
Okay. I received a letter from the Coquille Tribe on the Coquille Falls Chinook Conservation Hatchery Program and also the issue on the smallmouth bass up there competing with the salmon. I just got the letter on the 29th. I have a copy on your desk. They would really like to have a letter of support from Curry County for their hatchery program, which I'm in full support of. But what I would need to do is, I didn't get the letter done since the 29th. I've been waiting for some assistance on this. I'd like to present it to the board, but I'd like to have approval today, or at least discuss that further under other if we can.
Sure.
Because the deadline for... public comment to the Oregon Department of Fish and Wildlife is
We could actually add that under
other
discussion action.
If you want, that's fine.
Discussion, yeah.
That'd be okay, Council
yeah.
Poe. Okay.
J.K.
Thank you.
Smallmouth.
Yeah. Smallmouth is the... Never mind.
Didn't we already do a... They were here. Didn't we already do a resolution or a... Anyway.
That was a different program.
Okay.
And I can bring some light on that if you like. So I'm ready to...
Make a motion?
Yes, please.
Okay.
That we approve the agenda for the meeting today as amended.
All right. I'll second that. All in favor say yes?
Yes.
Yes. Motion carries 2-0. JJ, we don't do anything with saying one is absent or you'll just note it. Yeah, okay. All right, prior to the public comments, court had a request for, go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Line of duty death report, we were doing this all through 2019 and 20. The reason I wanted to bring it up today, and I mentioned it in the last meeting, it's a 15% raise in police officer tragedies, line of duty deaths, and most of those are either by an automobile crash, but it's 39 by gunfire. And I read an article earlier today that some of these are ambushed in some of our men and women. And so I just want the public to be aware. Prayer there. It's a very, very difficult job. Oregon still has not lost a soldier, police officer in several years now, and I hope that continues, and I hope those numbers go down and that percentage of increase 2022 over 2021 starts to decrease. That's all I have for this meeting, Mr. Okay. Chair. Thank you.
Your microphone's going to slip off.
Yeah, it always does on this time. Quit wearing it.
This time we'll have public comments. We'll do after public comments. We will introduce. We have an introduction, but right now on the agenda is public comments. 3 minutes per person. Mary Rowe is up.
I apologize, but my glasses are fogged, so I have to pull my mask down, even though the CDC wants us to wear a mask indoors again.
Who does?
The CDC. I'm Mary Rowe. I hope that Commissioner Pasha's health will be good enough for him to be here at the next meeting. We need him on this VOC. I am here to speak about the proposed consumption tax. This tax cannot pass because of the condition that a large percentage of our citizens are in. Due to the effects of the COVID virus pandemic on our economy, such as the incredible increase in rent, our citizens cannot pay a 3% consumption tax for 6 months a year, nor afford to stockpile to avoid paying it for the 6 months it would be in effect during tourist season. Whether one is below the poverty level is determined by one's gross income with an adjustment for inflation. A new category, which has been accepted by many states, including the state of Oregon, is ALICE, which is an acronym for Assets Limited, Income Restrained, Employed, which looks at how people can afford to live and work. Determining if someone fits into the ALICE category involves looking at a person's gross income and some necessary expenses, those being rent, food, health care, child care, necessary travel or commuting, electricity, and phone. In Oregon, 44% of the population are below the poverty level or are ALICE. In Curry County, 14% of the population in 2018 were below the poverty level and 33% were ALICE, for a total of 47%. In our senior citizen population, 56 were either below the poverty level or were ALICE. ALICE households struggle to survive financially and many cannot. Factors such as the huge increase in rent due to the COVID virus pandemic are destroying ALICE households, and many households are no longer eligible for vouchers because the rents are too high to qualify. The best nonprofit that provides some help countywide to our citizens who can no longer make and meet, to the expenses that our citizens can no longer make and meet, is the Brookings Harbor Community Helpers Food Bank and Resource Center. If you need work boots, medicine, etc., this organization supplies what others do not. But this nonprofit is so overwhelmed that they now must use 10 storage units, including 2 cargo containers, around town, in addition to the small buildings on their property. The ARP guidelines explained that the funds were largely meant to help families and households, including single elder households, and later included county governments being allowed to reimburse themselves for losses due to the COVID virus pandemic, not for insufficient revenue not caused by the COVID virus pandemic. So spending so much of the American Rescue Plan funds on our county government is fraudulent. Our citizens require that a much larger portion of our ARP funds be spent on helping those hardest hit by the pandemic. Implementing a program of buying new vehicles needs to wait at least the 7 vehicles that you want to be paid for with ARP funds at this time until you can afford to pay for them out of county funds. You will not be able to generate new revenue in the form of a consumption tax if you keep the ARP funds meant to rescue our citizens. The 47% of our citizens who are below the poverty level or are ALICE cannot and therefore will not vote for it. You cannot first deny them the help that they are entitled to and then tax them 3%. Therefore, I ask that you rescind your vote to spend $250,000 on ARP funds on 7 county vehicles and instead invest it in the Brookings Harbor Community Helpers Food Bank and Resource Center. Thank you.
Brett Cecil is next. You can give those to JJ, please.
Good morning, commissioners. Good to see you all. It's been a little while since I've been here. Good morning, staff, and everyone that's here attending the meeting this morning. I'm Brett Cecil of Port Orford. I'm the chair of the Curry County Democrats as well as the Democratic nominee for the State House of Oregon in House District 1. I came this morning because I wanted to give a quick report on our county fair that we had this past week. It was, I thought, a fantastic turnout. Unfortunately, I didn't get to spend a lot of time outside of our booth, but I did get to meet a lot of really fascinating people. We had lots of tourists come through. Just everyone enjoying themselves. It was good to see people getting back together. I just hope everyone was being safe and we don't have an outburst of COVID after this. But most of our events were outdoors, so I think we're going to be pretty safe. I do also want to thank Mary for giving her statement this morning. I agree wholeheartedly with her at this point. And being that you do have a quorum today, I would like to recommend you at least hold discussion on these issues that Rich has on the agenda. I know it would be a good idea to have all three commissioners present to make these decisions as far as a vote, but I think the discussion is really needed and we shouldn't put this off any longer than we need to. I would also like to, in that vein, request that you give some consideration to changing the release of the timing on our agenda for these meetings. I think I received 5 emails yesterday during the course of the day telling me that something was canceled or something was updated, something was changed. The public can't come into these meetings, and you need the public here. You need input from us so that you get a feel of what's going on out in the world. And I know far too many people that would love to come in and speak with you and give their 2 cents, but can't do it at the last minute. We need an opportunity to review the agenda so we know that what we can talk about with you and not just phone call and email. The in-person possibilities, I think, are really, really important. I'll kind of leave it at that.
Okay.
All right. So just to toss a little more on the agenda, I did have an opportunity yesterday at the Port Orford Planning Commission meeting to have the same discussion with them. They had a meeting without even putting an agenda out. And again, the public wants to be involved. We want to be part of what's going on here, but when we don't know what's happening, there's no way for us to do that. So the chair mentioned that the same thing we've talked about here. We're only required to give a 24-hour notice. The discussion was about minimums. I think we can do better in Curry County than the minimum. I think we need to step up and do better. So I will ask you, Chair Herzog, give that some consideration, please. I would love to attend these meetings, and I've tailed off a little bit because I don't know what's going on until the night before. So I don't really have any need to come and make input when I don't know what's happening. So I would appreciate that. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
I see a hand.
Quickly, we did change that to Monday at noon, so we gained you almost another 24 hours. So. I didn't know if you're aware. So.
Well,
I was getting notices at 11:45 yesterday about change, and there was a workshop cancellation, but I didn't get a notice that there was a workshop. So it's really confusing.
Well, it's automatic unless we cancel it.
Yep.
The workshop is automatic.
We're kind of in flux right now with a man down, so that, yeah.
I'm just here to report to what it looks like out here.
Okay.
And I know I talk a lot about confidence and trust here in the board, and this is one of the things, the transparency and accountability. It makes it really difficult for us to have a lot of trust.
Well, my
commissioners, I want to help. I want to work with our board of commissioners, and so do most of the public.
Yeah.
It's just really difficult to do when we don't know what's going on.
My recommendation would be just on the first and third Wednesdays, just show up at 9 o'clock.
You're on my calendar, but I don't know what to talk about until I get here.
Come a little early. So, just a second. We're going to move up. Okay.
Sorry. David Barnes, I'm the county treasurer. I also want to comment on the county fair that happened last week. It was the first time doing it for Caitlin and Tricia and their staff over there. It was my first time doing it as a treasurer. And we had over 7,000 people come through the gates in the fair in 4 days.
Wow.
We did a really good gate over there. And I want to let you guys know that you could not have a better staff working at the fair right now. Through everything that we went through, Caitlin came through it all with a smile on her face.
Good.
Never once did she frown. Everything had happened, from the ride showing up late to the problems with parking and the carnies and everything else. Caitlin and her people were just on top of everything. They were an absolute pleasure to work with through the entire thing. And I saw the faces of the kids. I got to do the payouts on the premiums for the exhibits at the fair, and a little girl, 4 years old, won $1, and she was happy as happy could be. And I put the form on the counter that she had to sign, and her father reached for it, and I said, "No, you didn't enter the fair. She did." And I let her scratch out her name, and it took up the whole form, the whole claim form, but she got her whole name on there, and she was just so happy to be involved with everything. And the looks on the children's faces and the thanks from the parents for having this again and their children being involved with it. It was, you know, for all the garbage that I deal with here and everything else, it just really, it made up for all of it. So many people had a great time, and, you know, I'm looking forward to doing this again with everybody next year. And
good.
I just want to let you know that. Thank you.
You bet. That's good stuff. Hey, so 7,000, does anybody have an idea what, in the past, what's a number? I know we're probably down, but
we're down a little bit. I've heard in past years that sometimes it was between 8 and 10.
Okay.
But this is the first time we've had a fair in 3 years.
Yeah. So
you know, last year we had a fair, but it was just rides and food. We didn't do any displays or any contests. This is the first year since 19, I think, that we've actually had a full-fledged fair with the contests and the 4-H kids there and everything. So, you know, it was a learning experience for all of us.
Yeah.
And, you know, we'll get together in the next couple of weeks and have meetings about what we can do better. But it was just, everybody is pleased with the attendance and the time that they had. So thank you.
Real good. Yeah, real quick.
If I may, really briefly, I just want to back Dave up on that. I think the tourism impact was really, really good. I did meet a lot of people that were here visiting from out of town, anywhere from Northern California. We had people from Washington. I think I met some people from Kansas. So there were people from all over, and it's a really great event for us.
Yep, it was. So, Julie, come on up with Mr. Jerome. Frank Jerome is our new finance director. Go ahead, Julie.
Julie Swift, payroll and HR. I want to introduce to you Frank Jerome, who's our new finance director. He started on Monday, so he's back for day 3. We're very excited. So, Frank, if you want to introduce yourself.
Welcome, Frank.
Thank you. I'm Frank Jerome, and I'm very pleased to be here. I hope I have a skill set that I can positively contribute to the county and work on behalf of the citizens and the board. Thank you.
Well, welcome, and it's good to have you. Anthony or Court have anything to chime in? It's nice because Frank and his wife have actually lived here a little over 3 years, so you didn't have to find housing.
No, we had a house.
Yeah,
We actually been here coming up on our second year full time.
Okay.
But the year before we were trying to spend as many weekends and bring up as many loads as we could.
So, Mr. Chair, I went to the fair Saturday night, and guess who was collecting gate receipts?
Frank Jerome.
Frank and his wife, Mr. Jerome and his wife, Julie. And
that's what finance directors do. They collect money.
I went in to just say a quick hello on Monday. No, excuse me, was it Monday? Yeah.
Yes.
And I said, you know, it's a pretty cheerful place to work here. We have JJ over in our office, but you have Julie and Elizabeth. So
yes, and they're wonderful.
Just welcome.
Thank you.
And I have tremendous confidence in your ability and your personality and your qualifications, all the above.
Well, I hope I can live up to your expectations. Thank you.
Anthony, you have anything?
No, just welcome.
Thank you.
Yep, if you don't have to talk to Anthony, you're not in trouble with any law
okay,
stuff.
That's
so
good.
Yeah. And you met the sheriff, so you've met pretty much everybody, all the...
Yes, Julie took me around on a little field trip so I could be introduced to the different departments and meet the people.
You got everybody's name memorized?
No, if I take a test, I'm going to do very badly on it.
It'll come.
But hopefully I recognize the faces.
All right. Well, welcome again, Frank.
Thank you.
Frank? Yeah, where I was thinking James. What? I never mind. I just had a little bit of a brain gas moment. And,
like Jesse James or what?
Rewind. Yeah, I don't know. Okay, so at this moment, we'll have, I'd look for a motion to approve the consent agenda.
One second, Mr. Chair.
A through G.
Oh, just want to play Jeff Bonato. That's really good to hear. I'm ready to ask for approval of the consent agenda, Mr. Chair. So moved.
I'll second that. All in favor say yes.
Yes.
I'll say yes, and so it's 2-0. JJ. At this time, we'll go into discussion action items. First one on the agenda is discussion of referral to a measure to the electors for an opt-out of Measure 109 regarding the psilocybin service centers and manufacturing. Becky Crockett. Becky? Usually you're right on the... So she's probably on her way up the stairs right now.
Mr. Chair, while we're waiting, if I may?
Sure.
I'm actually not very familiar, and I'm going to make it a good cause to become familiar with Measure 109. But I just wanted to, and we could take about 10 different shots at pronouncing this, this hallucinogenic.
Yeah.
Alkaloid, so I'm just going to give you the Wikipedia version, found in some toadstools. Psilocybin, I think is how you pronounce it, is a naturally occurring psychedelic prodrug. I've never heard that term, excuse me.
Prodrug
compound produced by more than 200 species of fungi. The most potent are members of the, I'll leave that out, but... psilocybin has also been isolated from about a dozen other genera. I don't know what that means. I might have clipped off the copy paste. But it is itself inactive, but is quickly converted by the body to psilocin. Psilocin. So I'm going to learn more because there's apparently going to be a pressure around the state and counties and local governments to understand more about this, and I'm very happy to see the work that Director Crockett did in putting this on the agenda and helping us opt out of this, and that would so anxious to hear her report. Thank you, Mr.
Come on
Chair.
Up, Becky. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm Becky Crockett, County Planning Director. Actually, it was the council's office that got this on the agenda, and they tricked me by putting my name on it.
Okay.
And what it did is it forced me to be able to say psilocybin. What this is just requesting your action to go forward with a ballot measure, to put this on the ballot for the folks of Curry County to let them decide if they would like to opt out of this program. Right now, throughout the state of Oregon, most counties are opting out, not because they have made a decision about whether or not this is a beneficial factor for them to incorporate into their county rules and regulations. It's really the issue of the Oregon Health Authority not being prepared as far as the rules and regulations and how to monitor and accept services to provide this opportunity for people. So a lot of the opt-out ballot measures that are going out are because people just don't really have a good understanding of how this program would work. There are some cities, Ashland is one, that is readily taking on the opportunity to want to have these centers within their jurisdiction. But I can say right now, most counties are prepared to have the ballot to opt out. But beyond that, that's all this is about, is to ask you if you would like to have us prepare the ballot measure and get it on the ballot and see what people in Curry County think about it.
Because we can't, as a county, say no. We have to, it has to be a ballot measure?
That's correct.
Yeah. So I'll make that motion to refer this to the electors for an opt-out measure on 109.
I'll second with discussion, Mr. Chair.
Okay, discussion.
I just want to make sure that we have the means to encourage the citizens to be informed on what this is, so that we don't lose this, this vote on opting out. So that's all I would add to that, Mr. Chair. I was up real late playing with my grandkids last night, okay. So I'm not in my best form today.
All right.
There are some counties that are providing the opportunity for public interaction, a workshop to have the discussion, at least to hear what people have to say about it and to publicize that workshop.
So this isn't going to be one of those things where the ballot will be one that you scratch your head. So, John, you want to speak to that maybe? Or?
Look what happened with 110.
Measure 110, or you can speak to that if you would.
Measure 110 was the one that really kind of put a cog or a broken wheel in our cog, however you want to pronounce it.
Right.
But it's basically legalized methamphetamine and heroin to just a violation for user amounts. And it's cost less than a seatbelt ticket if you get caught with it.
$50.
And then there's no repercussion. They took all the money that was coming from marijuana tax money that was going to law enforcement to help, go against all the illegal drugs, and put it towards programs for people with addictions. But come to find out, there wasn't a lot of programs out there. So there's millions of dollars just stuck in a pot in the state for that money. But 110 basically tied our law enforcement hands to how we, enforce illegal narcotics. The ballot measure was misleading. It was talking about, programs to help, we'll put the money in there, but that's not what happened. What happened is it just tied our law enforcement hands across the state. And you talk to other states, and they're basically laughing at Oregon because of that. So that's measure 110. I would just say if they're going to do something like this, I would say opt out, but make sure the ballot title is legible.
Description.
And understand, and everybody can understand what it actually is.
So, Becky, can you speak to that as far as, or Anthony, do we have any say in how that description of this ballot measure?
Yeah, I would be in charge of drafting that.
Okay.
So it would be, I do want to point out that I talked to Shelley Denny in the elections office yesterday, and we would have to have our notice for publication done by this Friday. So I don't think there's going to be a lot of time for public meetings or input. If it's something we're going to move forward on, we'd have to vote it for today, and then I'd have to get working on that.
But we could have public workshop
after
we get the
things,
yeah, that's kind of what I was thinking, is that you'd have an opportunity to clarify if there's any confusion about what's on the ballot, so people have the opportunity
prior to the November
prior to the actual vote,
right.
Yes,
but not before making the decision to put it on
right.
The ballot. So I think there's a miscommunication.
And there are some really good examples out there already, because Deschutes County is one who's completed their ordinance process and has actually prepared a ballot language that I think is very clear, and we have access to that, and a lot of other counties are using that as their model also.
And your recommendation is to pass this opt-out?
If we don't, yes, yes, absolutely. If we don't opt out, there's an element of this that requires us to change our comprehensive plan and our zoning code for time, place, and manner. That's the term that's used as far as where do you allow these facilities to occur. If you don't do the follow-up step, or if this is approved by the voters such that they want it here, currently it is allowed outright in all of our agriculture and forestry zones. So you could have multiple facilities pop up unless you enact zoning regulations to try to steer the places that you want this to happen.
Okay. All right. Any more discussion?
It's hallucinogenic, and so I don't know what the possible positive or medical aspects of this would be to the public. As the sheriff just said, Measure 110 had incredible unintended consequences. The voters of Oregon passed 110 on the promise the marijuana revenue would bring greater behavioral and mental health services to the state. And that did not happen. And it actually had a backfire approach that's been really tough on our culture. As the sheriff said, we're a laughing stock around the country. And so ballot measure 110 needs to be repealed. And that can be part of our argument, Mr. Chair, for why we want this on the ballot and why we need the people to understand what this could bring to our county. Thank you.
Clear and comprehensive ballot description is what I'm, you know, really looking forward to. And it sounds like they have it in the Deschutes County Bend area.
Yes, I believe they do.
So we would replicate that. And all right, so I'm going to call for the...
You want to make a motion?
Please. Well, I think
you did. I'm sorry.
You're allowing comment to come in, at least from staff. Would you allow any public comment to be made on this issue at this point?
Since we got a kind of a short
meeting. Very brief.
Very brief, please. Yes? Yep.
Brett Cecil, Port Orford. I just want to mention that Measure 109 was on the ballot. Oregonians voted for it. I think we do our homework when we vote. We also voted for 110, and it passed. So... please don't disrespect the voters. We do understand what we're doing. And we haven't diverted all of the money from the sheriff's department out of 110. Some money has been diverted, and it is for mental health care. And it may take some time to get those mental health care facilities up and running. But it doesn't mean that we shouldn't do it. So I want you just to give some consideration that you're asking the voters that voted for 109 now to say we don't want the county to do anything about it, or that we want to opt out of what we voted for. Just keep that in mind when you put it on the ballot.
Yeah, but I will definitely say that 110 was a gaffe.
Because we also did vote for campaign finance reform. That still hasn't happened, but I don't hear anybody barking about that here. 80% of Oregonians voted for that, and it hasn't happened.
And that's not what we're talking about, Brett.
We weren't talking about 110 either. We were talking about 109, but somehow that got brought in.
Okay, you can sit down now and listen to me blabber on about...
I'm going to.
Sit down.
Thank you, Mr. Herzog.
And I'll blabber on about riding back to Brookings with Lieutenant John Inslee. Is he Lieutenant? Okay. And him telling me how we are, as a county and as Oregon, If kids get caught with marijuana or with heroin or methamphetamine, they get a $50 ticket. And he said they don't, and there's nobody follows up on, they don't have to pay the ticket. But if a kid gets picked up with a bottle of beer or gets caught drinking, it's a huge fine. John, you can probably speak to this more. So we have, you know, and it's all bad. Alcohol at a young age is bad. Drugs are bad. But we, through this 110, and through the not making it so a simple guy can just read it and understand, you know, what you're voting for, they got this passed, and it has been a boondoggle, as our sheriff said, and everybody has said, most everybody. So anyway, that's my. Rant on that. So we are going to move on with all in favor say yes.
Vote. Yes. Yes. Whoop. Did
right,
you have something?
Yeah. Vote on it.
I'm sorry. Okay. Yes, and my vote.
And I'll say yes. So motion to move that along as passed. So the next thing on the agenda is Charles, are you out there? Exterior wall on sheriff's office contract. So I brought this forward as liaison commissioner to maintenance and facilities.
By the way, we need to introduce him.
So I'll introduce Please. Charles Buchanan is our maintenance and facilities guy, and there was going to be some discussion in executive session on maybe his new title, but for right now he's the man of the hour.
I'm the guy.
So we have looked at. So a while back, I was walking around the courthouse. Sometimes I just have to get out of here and walk around the courthouse. And underneath sheriff's window outside, there's a, we call it an eyebrow. It's just this thing that sticks out. And the wall is actually giving away.
Yeah,
and
peeling apart.
It's peeling apart, and you can touch it, and it moves, and sand and debris fall out. So Charles went and got this, and I'm going to hand it over to Charles. He's got some pictures.
Yep.
Do we have a mouse or JJ?
Your arms are probably longer right there.
Yep. I can get that. Do you know how to? So we got pictures, and we got a bid, and. Boy, my hope is that this could...
This is the east wall of the sheriff's.
Yep.
Yes. Yep, that's its way here. And what John was saying is, further down in our pictures here, you can see where it's peeling away from the eyebrow, just like this right here.
It's just going to fall off, yeah.
It's going to fall off, and not only that, it could be a safety hazard because it's right at shoulder height, and somebody could walk into it and get hurt. But we had Salvador's Rock come in and to give us a bid, and he's really excited about this project. It sounds like he had given us a bid before, which was really high, but he didn't really understand what was to be, you know, what was super necessary on the building here. He came back and we looked through it, and you could see where all of this here is cracking. He wants to clean out and reface that with the cement material that is supposed to be on there, and dig into where it's needed to not just plaster something up there and walk away from it, but an actual fix so that the wall will quit deteriorating so fast. He's going to come through here and grind all these out, re-cement, and then if we can go back to, this is the eyebrow that's super bad.
Go back first picture.
Yep. Right there. And that picture down here.
You want the mouse?
Yeah.
So you know where you're going.
I wouldn't be in much help, Charles.
No, you're doing good. Thank you.
So as Charles mentioned earlier, how we got a high bid. He was thinking that this was
he was thinking
stucco.
That the face was all stucco,
but it's not.
Have to tear the whole face off and then redo it with stucco. But he came to take a look, and let's see, where are we here? It's not a stucco, it's a cement material on there that's spread on there, and so that brought the bid down significantly from, I think, where it was 33,000. 11,000 now, what he wants to do out here. He's going to start out by pressure washing the whole face, get everything super clean. These cracks here, this will be a major repair. He'll tear this part apart and rebuild that, form it, and make it a nice piece. And you can see over where we've got lot of these areas here where it's not falling apart, but it's just rusted. This is all going to be ground out, cleaned out. And he's going to spray OSPO on there to stop the rust, and then repatch that with the cement material. Let's see, these eyebrows here, same thing. Clean this up and take it back as far as, you know, what
get rid of what cancers are in there and come back again and spray the OSCO to stop or help stop the rust from coming back.
And put another coat of the cement
on the face and where need be on the back side there.
After that, I'll put the cement up. There we got that one. I'll go back up to the top. Clean everything off. He's going to have scaffolding out there, so we'll have to set up barriers and whatnot just to protect people from getting into his area, keep his work area clean. Then he'll, when he's finished with that, paint the whole face and make it look nice again. And his goal is to make this look as nice as possible, and that we might ask him to keep walking around the building. And when we get to, say, maybe the courthouse, a lot of his work, patch repair, that if he could do on the outside, would take care of a lot of leaking on the inside of the building there, and that would alleviate a lot of problems on the inside. So we're hoping that this project is kind of just a kicker to walking around the building and taking care of things. So that's why we is super excited. His father has done a lot of work here on the rock walls and stuff like that. So I think they're very qualified, and they're super excited about this project. He's one that when we were out talking about this, he loves the community and would just like to, you know, have his name on this. And, you know, look what we've done. We've made this nice again. So that's where.
Well, I'm all in favor for it. We have a lot of water that comes into the we had some on Joel Hensley's office come through that exterior wall.
Same thing.
That's going to fix that, and I think it might be a cure for until we get a new courthouse, jail, and annex building. All this, it's very reasonable. I think the price it's over $10,000, so it has to come before the board. But I think it's just a great opportunity to see what he can do. And
exactly.
So I won't make the motion since I'm the liaison commissioner, but I'll let you go ahead with question.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just a couple quick questions and one comment. Yes, Mr. Salvador is very popular, in especially Central Curry County. Window replacements, what's the condition there?
Window replacements, they're older. They're not failing yet.
Okay.
So that, I guess, yeah. Ones that I've seen, I haven't noticed anything, but I guess they're older, they could be replaced, and I can for sure look into that and get somebody to come out and make a bid for that if you would like.
I wouldn't ask to replace them. I just was kind of hopeful that we could buy a little time with this project and support. So as of right now, anyway, they're adequate at best.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. And are we talking just the east wall here?
Just the east wall here.
Okay, we did a little bit of work 3 years ago on the south wall,
mm-hmm.
and I'm hoping that is holding up reasonably well.
Right, it seems to be.
Okay, so the entire, including down to the entrance?
Yes.
Good, okay.
Yep.
And you said 11,000?
11,000.
Okay. 11,122.
Yep, and that's materials and just the complete repair of that face.
Time frame to get it done, roughly?
He said it would be about 2 weeks. Okay. And his schedule, I think, is super flexible. If we can get the yay and I can give him a call, I think he would jump right on top of it and we can get the things going super quick.
Great, Mr. Buchanan.
Okay, I'll entertain a motion.
So moved that we approve this East Wall Sheriff's Office repair project, Mr. Chair.
I'll second that. All in favor say yes.
Yes.
I say yes, so motion carries 2-0. Thanks, Charles.
Hey, thank you.
Good presentation. How do we shut that thing off?
I'll let you do that.
Okay.
I'll get it somewhere we don't need to be. Thank you.
It's a start. I think it's a really good start, and if it turns out good, we could just keep moving around that building and gets the water intrusion, especially in the new DA's office, that comes in quite horrendously. So next up, Roadmaster Signature Authority, on the Myrtle Creek Bridge replacement project. Rich?
Good morning, commissioners. Thank you for promoting Jeff Bonotto to road worker to inspector for the road department. We had our first pre-con meeting on the Don Cameron Bridge repair yesterday, and he attended, and he will be leading all the non-critical inspections for that bridge, and Dyer will be leading all the critical inspections that require an engineer to perform. So we're really excited about that. Thank you. So Myrtle Creek Bridge, Curry County Road Department was awarded the Myrtle Creek Bridge for $2.1 million to replace that bridge. Our out-of-pocket cost will be about $212,000 if you choose to sign this agreement. And this will save our road reserves $1.8 million for the replacement of this bridge. That is a master plan project.
This doesn't need a lot of discussion, does it?
Nope.
I'm ready to make a motion.
Okay.
To approve the signature authority's state agreement number 8995 on the Myrtle Creek Bridge project.
Second. Any other discussion? Anthony, you got anything?
Nope.
All in favor say yes?
Yes.
I say yes too, so motion carries 2-0.
Good work, Roadmaster Christensen.
Thank you very much.
So if you want to stay there and speak to the skid steer.
Yes. So the skid steer, this is a piece of equipment that, I have too much stuff here, sorry.
It's okay.
I was prepared to handle all the other items on the agenda as well. The skid steer, this is a $184,000 package, and this equipment will help as part of our master plan to conserve road funds. We did a project this year in January where we ground out major patches on Jerry's Flat Road, and instead of blade patching like we normally would, we hired the state, and with all the labor and equipment, traffic control and grinding, we did a project for $12,000 that would normally have cost us $40,000. So we saved $28,000 with grinding equipment. And the nice thing about it is, instead of, when you grind the road, that's called, that what's the byproduct is recycled asphalt product, RAP. And it has value of $12 a ton. And Tidewater, our local rock purveyor and asphalt maker, will trade us ton for at $12 for base rock and our riprap. So putting all that together, having this equipment saves road dollars. And this equipment is part of a large package of $2.25 million of equipment that we're trying to buy this year, and I'd like to talk about that. The road department saved $3.815 million this year because of all our new equipment, our training, that, and grants. This year we cut paving costs $660,000. We only paved three miles of road instead of 6 miles like we normally did. So we also saved $525,000, not chip sealing 17 miles of road. We only chip sealed 4.5 miles of county roads. We earned revenue of $800,000 for chip sealing 17 miles of Bear Camp Road, highly successful project. We were awarded $30,000 in AOC grants funding to apply for $40 million of federal and state grants for all our master plan projects. We, as I said earlier, we saved $1.8 million with being awarded Myrtle Creek Bridge. Just this year, the road department saved $3.815 $1.5 million. Okay, this is not even talking the last 4 years. You know, I could talk about the last 4 years, all the dollars we had saved too. And the, you know, that, you know, let me just touch a little bit of that. In the last 4 years, we have received $8.5 million of grants, saving $7.5 million in road reserves. We have chip sealed 29 miles of Carpenter Road, bringing revenue into the road department. We've done major team building with problem solving, communication with a commitment to excellence. We built interagency agreements with ODOT, U.S. Forest Service, City of Gold Beach, and City of Brookings. We've joined the MORE agreement so we could work with 34 other sister counties in Oregon. We, like I said, we cut our paving costs from $6 million a year to $3 million a year these last 4 years. We cut our, so anyways, and we're saving by doing that. And we've increased our chip seals from 8, 10 miles to like 17 miles a year, which has overall saved our road department $300,000 a year by changing how we do things in our paving and maintaining our roads in a fair to good condition. It's, so the thing is that when I saw the pictures of the sheriff's office rushing away, you know what? A lot of the equipment we replaced the last few years looked just like that. Some of the equipment I need to replace right now looks like that. The reason why we were able to work 3 weeks for U.S. Forest Service this year is because all the new equipment we have, it doesn't break down in the middle field, in the middle of the project. Imagine if equipment would have broke down an hour and a half from here, 2 hours to bear camp, what that would have cost that project. And we, that project went really well. And so the thing is this is part of the road department master plan of saving money. So yes, the road department, we put $2.25 million into our budget this year, and we went line by line through it with the budget committee. Line by line, we talked about this in depth, and it was approved. And Curry County follows all the rules, and specifically the rules with our Curry County Local Contract Review Board rules. Everything that we've done in the history of road departments follow these rules to the T. And so this is part of their approved budget. And but there's another thing that's really pushing on us with this equipment, why I need to replace equipment and get approval for this, is that DEQ made us do reporting on all our heavy equipment that's diesel. And what's coming our way, I believe, is what's happening in California. What's happening in California, per my equipment operator that transferred from Siskiyou County Road Department to Curry County Road Department, they're stuck at that time, 3-4 years ago when he first came across here, with four dump trucks. Two of the dump trucks he could only use for emergency snow plowing. They could not leave that lot because they didn't meet the Tier 4 diesel clean air requirements. And the other two trucks, he could only drive 3,000 miles a year. That's less than 300 miles a month. We drive our dump truck sometimes 200 miles a day. You know, if I get stuck with this old equipment, and one is, I won't be able to resell it. You know, just recently we resold two dump trucks on public auction. One has broken down. We sold it for $22,000. And it was a 2003, had a broken radiator and some cooling and a hood. And the other one was a 1998 Kenworth, and we sold it for $41,600. And it was a 1998, but it was in fair to good condition. But it didn't meet the clean air rules, so we needed to move on. And so...
Okay, Richard, can I interrupt real quick? And I understand, and we're probably going to hear this again, because, you know, it was my understanding that Chris would be able to call in or remote in, and he's just... And so that's the reason, you know, the two of us... It's a three-member board, so we want to have, you know, and prayerfully he'll be able to make the next meeting. So, and that then we'll have that discussion on those other two items.
Well, but there's a cost associated with that, and I just wanted to finish with that cost.
Well, and we appreciate the money that has been saved, the grants, but I know this conversation is going to come up again in 2 weeks. So
yes, but the cost of this Kenworth equipment. Pape Kenworth in Medford notified me that in next week, everything goes up 7%. So when you're talking $1.2 million, 7%, you know how much that is? Just my rude math is maybe like 90 grand.
170.
80 grand. Okay. Well, 10% of 1.2 million is 120,000. So, you know, it's we're talking this decision not being made today is costing my team another $80,000. And so that's in the last in these master see I put in this budget 2.25 million cuz those are master plan numbers from a master plan we started working on 2-3 years ago. Well, you know, those costs now are 35% higher than what's recorded in the master plan. And costs keep escalating, and they're not going to stop, and they're not going to wait on us. And so the thing is that we're very hard working proactively to save money, and we have proven that. We have conserved major road funds these last 4 years by being more efficient, more effective. And this equipment is a huge part of that. And so I just want to let you know that that's why I talked about it all in a package. And I'll get back to this one piece of equipment, which is the CAT 299 D3 XE grinder. Pash wanted me to look at John Deere, and I did. And I reached out to Don Deere, and it's been difficult. And I have got a quote, and it's about $20,000 less. And so I asked them for references for other cities. I couldn't get any. CAT gave me 5 in just our region. I talked with Josephine County. They just bought under this Sourcewell agreement just recently this exact unit. I talked with Coos County, where we do a lot of interagency equipment swaps. They have this equipment, and it's their go-to equipment. They use it on all their sinks. And Curry County Road Department has over 300 sinks. I think it's about 350 sinks. And like it is expressed on Jerry's Flat Road, the savings. You know, instead of paying $40,000, we only paid $12,000. And I talked with City of Coos Bay, and this is their go-to equipment for patching. And they love this equipment. So I had three highly sister counties and cities in our region that really support this equipment, even though it's a little bit more expensive. And, you know, it's I don't want to take a chance on having something that may not be as efficient or effective when I know I have huge Caterpillar support. They're here next day if we call them. South Coast Lumber, there's so much CAT equipment in our region that CAT is here all the time for factory support. And so anyways, I would just like to, if we could at least this one item, get it approved by the board today to move forward, I would appreciate that.
And that was my original thought, but I don't want to change my approach that I need more time on this, and I think having all three commissioners here is very wise. The job you've done, and again, I don't hand out compliments very easy, but I think, as you mentioned, the grants and the matching funding and all that. I think what I'm going to do is just try and come down to your campus, your yard, and I want you to walk me through and show me the equipment that's going to be replaced. I need to be better informed.
Okay.
I'm not saying this isn't money well spent. You just on the two big items, you're going to need to show me, and I can report back to the board, or you could go down also at some other time. So I'll make a motion if you're ready, Mr.
Yep.
Chair, on the skid steer with the one new trailer. For $184,000 to approve that today.
I'll second that. So let's go. All in favor say yes?
Yes.
I'll say yes too. Motion carries 2-0.
So thank you.
Stay up there because we're going to talk about the logo.
Oh, thank you.
So the next thing on the agenda is the approval of the Historic Road Department logo. You know, and there's been some discussion on this logo, and I actually like this old logo. It has Brookings, Gold Beach, Port Orford, Agnes, Langlois on there. fishing boats and cows and logs and trees and log trucks and...
There, that snow on the one? No.
I think it's just a cloud. Mac Arch is on there. And so there's been some discussion, and I'm old enough to remember when I started with UPS in 82, not too many years later, if you saw a license plate, you knew that car was from Missouri just by the, just by the color, because states only had one or two license plates, and that was it. Now you can't decide who it is, because I think Oregon probably got 12 or 15 different kinds of license plates. So I'm not a huge a proponent of just saying we got one county logo. I like this logo. I like a logo like that. I mean, I like our logo that we have right now that is just says Curry County. So, Rich, if you want to speak, so it shows the logo underneath. We don't have a picture of it up there, do we, JJ?
Right. This is just discussion. We could make it where we have the pictures come on the big screen so the community could see what we're talking about. But this has been part of my 4.5-year plan or 5-year plan since I started working here with the team building. And we placed, I don't know if you might be able to see it, this logo on the back of our safety sweatshirts for the crew this year for their high visibility. And this shows the whole shape of Curry County, all our wild rivers, logging activity, fishing activity, ranching activity, and it shows our that it's official use, Curry County, Oregon, And so, but anyways, these stickers would be $15 each, so $30 per vehicle. We wouldn't put it on our older vehicles that we're planning to replace. We put it on our newer vehicles, and so it'd be $30 per vehicle. Our team building that we had last week with Jay Gubrud for communication, problem solving, and effectively work together was highly successful. All I've heard was great feedback from everybody that attended, from department heads and everything. And so this logo, my team said, hey, Rich, we'd like to have this as our official logo. And this is part of that team building. And the team, you saw that picture that was up on the board of us chip sealing Bear Camp Road, and we're standing by our big long equipment. And look at that team, how proud they are of that work and everything. And this just keeps feeding that energy of that commitment to excellence. So anyways, appreciate you looking at that. I'll provide some pictures for next time.
Court's got a question.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. A couple of things. I've never been thrilled with the marketing people say keep it simple. I understand that. But at the risk of offending whoever designed this 10, 20 years ago, the current logo that we have, vampires on the birds there. And I'm a Mac Arch fan. I don't think I'm the only one that thinks that. I really, like you, I like this old logo. You said a commitment to excellence. It's also a commitment to Curry County.
Absolutely.
And that is, stating the obvious, we live in a very special area. I would maybe just consider fine-tuning this just a little bit. Maybe you want to put California right there. It orients people in case we use this down the road to a greater extent, or Coos County at the north. Maybe just fine-tune it a little bit. And we've got people here that are good at that and could do that. That would be my recommendation, at least to consider that. And then you said you were just going to put it on new vehicles.
Yes, or newer. So we replace many heavy pieces of equipment in these last few years. And so...
Because it costs... It's
$30 per vehicle.
But it doesn't... to replace... peel the other ones off. That's not a... That's...
Pretty easy. The shop does it all the time.
A heat gun will help, but... So it's not a big deal.
No, it's not a big deal. They just stripped all the stickers off an ambulance for the sheriff department. That thing had stickers forever.
Okay. So, yeah, I like the old logo a lot.
And I like it that it's not a new logo. It's not something they came up with. It's a historic, it was used in the past, and...
And there's actual Mac arches on the logo.
Yeah.
It's just smaller.
Yep.
Could we add a salmon and a jet boat on there?
Yeah. And so, but anyways...
So I think this is more of just a discussion, this meeting, and, you know, go for the full board in the future. But, yeah, you should have brought one of those sweatshirts.
I will the next meeting.
Yeah, there you go.
And I just want to touch on the other discussion items. Please come down to our yard so I can show you the equipment. I will ask Kenworth, give me 2 more weeks. Can you hold this price for 2 more weeks? And I'll bring it back in 2 weeks. And, you know, I don't know if I can. You know, $80,000 is a lot of money to them too, right?
Yeah.
And so I'll do what I can.
Okay.
Thank you.
I look forward to a visit. Thank you, Roadmaster Christensen. And by the way, on the logo, you have Langless and Agnes, both. That's good.
Yeah. So, Court, you are up with Curry Suicide. It's 10 to 8. Let's take a break and
good
come
call.
Back for H&I, J&K. We'll come back at 20 after. Is that good? 10:20.
Thank you.
Why do counties matter? Simple. Counties provide the services we all depend on. If you're concerned about crime, get a regular flu shot, drive to work, take public transportation, or experience a natural disaster in your community, chances are you benefit from county services. That's why counties matter. With America's system of federalism, counties are a key level of government, serving the people directly. So, do you vote? Had a recent hospital stay? Know someone in a nursing home? More reasons why counties matter. There are 3,069 counties across the country, with populations big and small. Most of us live and work in one. Even the nation's capital is considered a county. These county governments ensure that the food you eat in restaurants is safe. They care for the mentally ill, run court systems, build local economies, and operate 911 emergency systems. They manage parks and recreation facilities. And the list goes on. Thing is, counties serve the American people in so many ways, keeping our communities healthy, vibrant, safe, and fiscally sound. That's why counties matter.
Everything starts out small. The things that hurt us,
They all start from somewhere. The words we say, the things we do, they can grow into something else. What was small and innocent can become big and sometimes scary. All it takes is one comment, one picture, one video for something to catch fire. But a big problem doesn't need a big response. Not at first. Even if we don't know what to say, the eye emoji can be that first step we take. Let's all pledge to take that first small step together and change the world in a big way. I'm a witness, and so are you.
If yours is the next big idea, and you need the right place to fine-tune it, build it, launch it, if you're only your best when you can play more than you work, if inspiration comes from the outside, you belong in Curry County. The westernmost point of the land you love, and the edge between familiar and uncharted. Break the pattern. Be where the airports are as close as the beaches, and industry and recreation never cease to amaze. Dock, dive, and dine in a single day, and never lose your connection. This is the threshold of the West. Live where you can do you, and do it well, at the farthest point from ordinary. Curry County, living on the edge.
There's a shelter pet who wants to meet you. Meet one today. Visit theshelterpetproject.org. Adopt.
One of the things I really appreciate about our entire region is that we embrace who we are, and I think that's what unifies us. Once the timber and fishing industries collapsed, it took us a long time to get back on our feet. People didn't quite grasp the idea that once these jobs left, they weren't going to get other family wage jobs, and it crippled us.
Things were getting really dire. So we just saw that this was an opportunity to maybe look at that public land a little differently and how it could bring more dollars into our region.
The Wild Rivers Coast is so unique because there are more wild and scenic rivers here than anywhere else in the lower 48 states. The scenic beauty is just amazing. There's so many different places to go, from the national forest down to the protected ocean, and it's just a really special place.
I guess I didn't really know how special it was, though, until I moved away to Portland and came back and saw all the potential here.
We're uncrowded, we're unspoiled, and we're a little difficult to get to, but my God, once you come here, you fall in love.
We just thought if we could pull people to come into this Wild Rivers Coast and stay longer and explore a little farther into our backcountry, there was a lot of opportunities for them to experience.
I think our whole future is at stake here. This area is ready to go. We just need to give it a little kick in the butt.
I'm gonna be honest, when the Rural Tourism Studio came here, I was skeptical because I didn't see far enough ahead that we actually could collaborate regionally. And I'm pleasantly surprised. It's been amazing.
The Rural Tourism Studios was the first time we were able to come together as a region to talk about the future of our economy.
If we can have a strong tourism economy in this area, it's gonna benefit the whole community.
We have to rely on ourselves, and I think through this program, it sort of opened our eyes to what we could do when we work together. Community leaders really focused on three areas: outdoor recreation, food and agricultural tourism, and really building community relationships.
In our area, a lot of the food that's grown all gets shipped away. And so now we're realizing that we can capture some of that local food that's grown here. The Eat Fresh and Local Action Team has hosted a series of networking events bringing together the area growers with the area vendors so that we could have more local food available to the visitors to our area. And now we're seeing more local food in our grocery stores, in our restaurants, and we have a new local food co-op.
We created a farm trail from Bandon to Port Orford. We did 9 U-Pick farms, and it just gained traction, and people loved it.
Langlois is less than 500 people. It's very small. So we have to bring in tourists. And being on the farm trail, even though it's just beginning, has really helped do that. We really want to make it a destination for anybody. My mom and I began Dragonfly Farm just 3 years ago. When I found out that I could grow a seed and turn that into food, it was like, oh my gosh, why wouldn't you do this? I just quit my day job and I just signed the paper to be an official co-owner of the farm. This is what I want to do for the rest of my life and grow with the community.
Out of the Outdoor Recreation Action Team, we came up with a series of maps that show where the best places to go recreate are. We know where we're going to send people now, and we got a great map that shows all the best places to go see.
For us to get a mapping project done to this extent is pretty impressive. We're patting ourselves on the back. I don't know if anybody else is, but we're doing it.
From that, we decided that there was some places that needed help. So we came up with a mountain bike plan, and we also worked on designating a state scenic bikeway. The Outdoor Recreation Action Team was also looking at how we can make scuba diving better in this area. So we came up with the idea for a scuba fill station. So now people that want to come and dive in this area, they can dive for multiple days because they can get their tanks filled up again. When I started the Rural Tourism Studio, my business, South Coast Tours, was really small. And now we've grown to about 5 or 6 guides, and we're doing tours all over from Brookings all the way up to Coos Bay.
Overall, tourism is on the rise here. We've had a bang up last 2 years, and it's like a breath of fresh air down here.
My hope for the area is that we still keep that sense of place.
Loving a place to death is a big concern that I have, and it's a balance. We're going to promote tourism, but we want to do it in a sustainable way. One of the biggest reasons that this area has been so successful since the Tourism Studio is the people that are involved. We have a lot of great, motivated, smart people who understand the need to promote tourism in the right way, and it's really all about the people.
When you live in a rural community like we do, from Bandon down to Brookings, and you're strapped for cash, relationships are crucial.
As a community, I think you need to come together and find out what your mission and goals are collectively. Then you can work into smaller groups, knowing that you have the backing of the whole community behind you.
As long as everybody's just super excited about it and passionate about what they're doing and they can work together, then anything's possible.
Own what you have and don't try to be something that you're not. It's gonna be hard. It's gonna take a long time. So roll up your sleeves and just dig in with an open mind.
many letters?
5 letters.
Just think about what am I doing right now.
Smile. Smile?
Uh-huh.
This is so easy.
Wildfire, as everyone knows, has emerged as one of the big major issues affecting Oregon and, for that matter, all western states. A real actionable response that's including how do we fight fire, actively managing our forests so that we don't have the fuels out there, and how are we going to protect communities from smoke exposures. The council is really set up to have a comprehensive strategy that's based on action and based on protecting our communities.
The primary focus we as a board have come through with is that in researching the policies for fire management, yes, prescribed fire has its place on the landscape, but not during fire season. We, as a county, passed a proclamation that says once the state fire marshal declares fire season, it'll be nothing but full suppression, and recently took a resolution to the National Association of Counties, essentially says that they support coordination between agencies and local governments for the health, safety, and welfare of the citizens regarding fire, prescribed fire, fire season, anything that affects our citizens.
This is Lily Morgan from Josephine County, and we are at the Rogue Leadership Forum today looking at the best possible partnerships that we can come up with to fight the fire issues and the smoke issues that we're facing in Southwest Oregon. So looking forward to coming up with solutions and the partnerships to get the job done so we don't face what we have the last few years with catastrophic fires and smoke that invades our communities for months to come. So this is a good opportunity, and we hope to be successful in the outcome.
Seeing so many people come together has really been exciting for me, because there's a lot of expertise, there's a lot of resources, and as we attempt to do a shared stewardship approach to keeping people safe, it's really important that we get together. So my name is Merv George Jr., and I'm the Forest Supervisor for the Rogue River Siskiyou National Forest. One of the first things is making sure to get fires out if they're threatening life and property. The second thing that I'm going to focus in on is when it's safe to do so, to put some fire on the landscape when it's cooler and not during fire season, to reduce these same fuels that are giving us so much fits during the fire season.
Bob Horton, I'm the fire chief of Jackson County Fire District 3 in Southern Oregon. The challenges that are facing us in terms of the mega fires and the wildfires that we've been experiencing out in this valley, particularly in the last couple of years, but across the state and across the region, incredibly concerning to us in the fire community, those in our communities in general, our constituents and our patrons are extremely concerned, as they ought to be. Really, the takeaway from the work that's being done now is this is an extraordinary collaboration of dozens on dozens of interested stakeholder groups who are coming together with a common purpose. It's really an inspiring showing of humanity to not only be able to provide for a greater quality of life for our people, but to be strong stewards of our land so that our future for us and generations to come is incredibly bright.
Very pressing issue. It's bearing down on us. Fire season is approaching, and I am really interested in preventing my home and other homes in my community from being impacted by wildfire, specifically from being burnt down. That's my main reason for being involved.
Quite a collaboration of folks. We're here looking for practical solutions to help us unravel some of the issues surrounding wildfires today here in the state of Oregon. And my focus really is on planning for large wildfire events in advance of their occurrence. That way, when they do occur, we can respond more appropriately to those situations.
Well, I just think it's grand of all of the people all over the state have come together today to be concerned about water. It just warms my heart, because I know that they really will leave here today feeling more impressed about the water, because I have told them that we're all born in water. We cannot live without it. It's our job to take care and stop the garbage in the rivers and streams and oceans, because there's life in that water. It's our job to keep it clean for them. But we cannot live on this planet without the animal kingdom. I was in Ohio at the Ohio River when Dr. Emoto, the Japanese scientist who had proven water could hear, he and I stood on the riverbank blessing the Ohio River that they had us come to do. And I prayed that God has still kept the river good for them over there. We were taught when we were little that prayer works. You too remember your prayers because they work. It has nothing to do with religion or church.
What draws you to the Oregon coast? Is it the green and blue surf on a brilliant sunny day? Or angry, boiling waves during a raging winter storm? Do you prefer quiet coves or powerful breakers churning the sand? How about sand castles? Do you come for the rising tide or the setting sun? To marvel at whales gliding through the sea or flying in the sky? Reasons to travel the Pacific Coast Scenic Byway are as far-reaching as your imagination. This is a spectacular part of Oregon that traces the entire coastline along Highway 101, guiding you to the sea and away again, to coastal towns big and small, lowland marshes, and breathtaking overlooks. It's a long byway stretching from the mouth of the Columbia River to the California border, 363 miles in all, of some of the most unblemished, awe-inspiring seascapes you'll find anywhere. In addition to its...
All right, welcome back, everybody. We are on H in our action/discussion items. Curry Suicide and Awareness Prevention Council's U.S. Grants Board of Commissioners approval. Commissioner Boyce.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This group... proud of the productivity, for lack of a better word, just a very active group representing the county. The primary thing I want to focus on today, other than we need to approve $480 in grant money that they will be spending on a couple different things, a logo and some coffee sleeves for a little bit of awareness, public awareness. But they have done really well. And you're probably familiar with the 988 nationwide number on suicide. you know, you matter, and I'll go to the next one here. Life is better with you. I think that's what it said. Let's see. No, the other one didn't come on. Is it that one? Yeah. Oh, here we go. Life is better with you here, the 988 number. So, Commissioner Herzog would like to ask that the board approve this $480 for the Curry County Suicide Awareness and Prevention Council to approve for these two expenditures.
Now, is that an ARP ask, or is it just?
No, it's money they've already had allocated.
Okay.
I think it's part of it. I'm not real familiar with the grant. I can't remember exactly what it is, but no, it's not ARP funds.
Okay. It's a grant, okay.
Mm-hmm. I think it's an ongoing grant.
So I'll make that motion. So moved. Do I have a second?
Second, Mr. Chair.
Okay, any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say yes.
Yes.
I say yes, so motion carries 2-0. I is you again, helping with the Veteran War Memorial.
Gentleman in Eastern Oregon by the name of Steve Bates has been devoting his life to this memorial that will be just on the northwest corner of the World War II memorial at the state capitol. A beautiful location, beautiful landscaping. Oh, I'm sorry. What am I doing? Here we go. Anyway, his name is Steve Bates, and he's finally been able to get approval and a little bit of momentum to have each county have a representative, and he's asking that to be a county commissioner. And you see in the packet, Mr. Chair, what that person would be doing, be responsible for. And I'll read that to the public here. Other than raising money, but that's a big one, of course, to help offset the cost of, this has been approved by the governor and the legislature, by the way. Each of Oregon's 36 counties are to have a VW MF chair. Each chair may appoint county captains to assist. The county chair will coordinate visitations with the various service organizations and the VWMF, that's a Veterans War Memorial Fund Speakers Bureau, coordinate efforts to invite businesses to become corporate sponsors and or partners, coordinate a bottle drop fundraiser program, coordinate the VWMF participation at various community events, and finally participate with the VWMF Capital Campaign Committee in various fundraising endeavors. So they've updated their brochure, and it's long overdue, but there's just been, this has got tremendous support, of course, at the Capitol with different legislatures, both parties, and it's a drive to essentially make this happen, especially now at the World War II Memorial is done, and so it's time to honor our Vietnam veterans, and I'm asking the board to authorize or approve my participation in this, and I'm just very excited about it.
So moved.
Well, I'll second, Mr.
Okay. All in favor say yes.
Yes.
I say yes, so motion carries 2-0. Moving along, we are at Portland State Salary Study. Portland, go ahead, Anthony.
Yeah. And just a quick background, every 3 years, the county is now required to have a salary study completed.
Okay.
It was put in the budget and approved by the budget committee and the board earlier to have this study completed. We received a quote from Portland State to complete that for us. The price was $9,625. So I'm just asking for permission from the board to sign that contract and get the salary study going.
Okay.
A couple questions, Mr. Chair.
Sure.
Requirement, who, that was an ordinance that the county did?
No, that was, it's an ORS, it's a new state law.
Can you give us just a little more detail on that? I was.
Yeah, no, so the ORS requires that every 3 years that the county does a pay equity
study. Every county, it sounds like, every not
county,
just, yeah.
Not just Curry County. And there's a lot of benefits for the county legally. If the county does fulfill the requirements of the ORS, we're protected from lawsuits from people who may have a pay equity litigation or to try that. And so basically it just makes us so that we're in compliance for the law, but it also offers legal protections.
Thank you. Are all the counties using Portland State?
I have no idea.
The reason I asked that, Council Pope, is you heard me in the consumption tax task force meeting the other day say that, generally speaking, Portland State has a pretty good reputation, but, we go back about 4 years, the dispatch study with Brookings having their own dispatch system versus, not versus, but in addition to Curry County, we were looking at coordinating those 5 or 6 years ago, right about the time I got here. Anyway, both Curry County and Brookings East paid $18,000. And we're both jointly discontented with the whole study. Very poorly done. I didn't read it, so those are not my words. But it was really a little bit of a sore spot. So, if we authorize this today, I don't know if we should. I guess I'm not recommending that we consider, offering a bid or looking for a bid, but I want to know that they are going to, not make Curry County last on the program, and that they're going to do a thorough job for us. And so I think we need to communicate that in some fashion. And also, I would like to know, and maybe this would be more my responsibility to research a little bit, see if the state is pushing Portland State or if they have any competition in this deal.
I know it happened before I got here, but I know the previous salary study, they went out and they found another company to do it, and I believe the price was in the mid to upper $20,000 range.
Curry so County did?
Yeah, that's correct.
Yeah.
And I know that there were some issues with that, and I do know, you know, that there are quite a few counties that use Portland State just because, when I was at Coos County, they used them, and I know some of the other counties, because we've received requests from Portland State for some of our salary information, so.
In terms of Coos County, were they relatively satisfied on that?
Yeah, no, I had no issues with them.
Okay.
Okay.
Come on in, Julie. Come on.
So there's several different companies and firms that offer this service to do the pay equity study. We had reached out to Portland State a few years ago when we were talking about doing it, and I just went back to them. So it's the state's not pushing them. It's not a recommendation by the state or anything. The firm that we had contracted with a few years ago, HR Answers, they have gone through some conversions and changes, and their process was very complicated, and they kind of dropped us, and long story. Anyway, I've heard good things about Portland State, and I just went back to them.
Okay, but you've had, in your view, we've had relatively good luck with them over the years?
I haven't worked with them before. I know they did, when David Itson was here, they did that kitchen table study, kind of a overview of the county, and it was one of those things where, how can we fix the county? And they gave us all these suggestions and we didn't do anything. But I've heard...
What year that was?
It was when Dave was here, so I don't...
Hey, what?
It was when Davidson was here, so I don't remember what year it was. But anyway, I just know they do these compensation studies, and I went back to them, and their cost seems relatively reasonable, and so far my dealings with them have been very positive.
Good.
Yeah, I'm not complaining here, other than I think I do speak for the city of Brookings and the county on that dispatch survey, and we pushed pretty hard, or I did push pretty hard to get them to redo it, and that didn't seem to gain any traction. So Portland State, who did the wage study 2 years ago, 3 years ago for us?
Julie Schmelzer.
Yeah, but it wasn't a private company.
No, wasn't anybody. She did it herself.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. We, in the past, 20 years ago, we used LGPI, but they're not offering that service anymore.
Unfortunately, right?
Yes.
Thank you. Yes.
Anthony?
Okay. That helps a lot.
I just want to point out that having it done in-house again, I think that just means questions and possible biases. So I think ideally...
And I wasn't promoting that. Thank you. And for that clarification, definitely.
Any other questions for Julie or Anthony? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion.
Can
the what?
Can anyone else ask a question?
Not normally.
It's referring to something that Mr. Boyce mentioned about the study. You probably can't hear me from back here.
Hi, Brett Cecil, Port Orford. But Mr. Boyce just mentioned a study that was done that you mentioned, Mr. Boyce, that was a bad study. What was that referring to? Because I didn't.
It was about coordinating or combining Brookings Police Department dispatch and Curry County dispatch.
And you're sure that was a bad study? Because then in the next sentence you said, but you hadn't read it. So I'm asking how you know it's a bad study if you didn't read it.
Go back and look at the minutes. I don't know what exact time it was. No, I didn't need to read it because nobody was satisfied with it. Nobody.
No one. All right, I have to go back and read the minutes then.
Thank you.
I just want to be clear on the bad study. Thank you.
So I'll entertain a motion for the Portland State salary study.
I will second, Mr. Chair, with discussion.
Okay.
I just want to make sure that study, that the Portland State University people know that due to the dissatisfaction with the dispatch study between the City of Brookings and Curry County, that we really want a thorough conclusion on their work.
So I would imagine the people doing this study are not the same people that did the dispatch study.
But they would need to know that we lost $36,000, in my view. So
anyway, probably totally different people don't have
separate.
It doesn't matter. They're representing the same entity, and I have a strong opinion about that.
Experience.
Yeah.
Is that a question we can ask?
If it's the same people?
Yeah.
No, to let them know that we lost money. That's not. Okay.
We can do that.
That's good business.
We can do that.
Okay. So if there's no more discussion, I'll
Gotta quit them talking in the back. That's starting to get starting to be a little bit of an issue, and it's disruptive. And I'm just going to ask politely, Mr. Okay. Chair, that we be aware of that because it will come up on the microphone.
It's noted. All in favor, say yes.
Yes.
I say yes. So motion carries 2-0. Last thing on the consent agenda or the action discussion item agenda is smallmouth bass in the Coquille River.
Mr. Chair, thanks for getting that on last minute. I'm hoping that I'll have a little bit of time tomorrow to contact Steve Byerlin, Oregon Outdoor, the Oregon Anglers Association, and get their view on this. But I haven't seen anything that the Coquille Tribe has recommended when it comes to natural resources that I've disagreed with almost without exception in my time as a commissioner. We know that the fish count on the Coquille River are absolutely shockingly low. And they're just all the communities, all the stakeholders have tremendous concerns about that. And so I would like to come back with a letter that you would be comfortable signing and Commissioner Pash would be comfortable signing in support of, and yes, this is a 4-page letter. Ours will only be 1 page, or maybe 1.25, 1.5, but with your approval, with the board's approval, then I think it would be really good for us to show support on this. And I'll try and get it done by Friday.
Okay. So I know that this is...
Friday morning,
unless
actually.
You're fishing for smallmouth bass, right? Because they're eating all the smolt of trout and
yeah,
salmon.
Yeah, they're invasive species.
Yeah.
On the Coquille River, and so they're outside even the competitor category, and so salmon is one of the most unique resources that we have in Oregon, and especially the southwest corner of Oregon, all of our wild rivers, and so yeah, I hope to have a letter that you'll be proud to sign.
Yeah, so look forward to seeing that on the 17th.
And thanks for getting that on the agenda this morning.
No problem. And I know, like, the Umpqua has a huge smallmouth fishery that they have actually
promoted. Yeah.
And guides go up. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
And that's what it started out as.
Serious hope.
So we are at
Thank
Commissioner...
Thank you. That was Matt Hall, by the way, for that input.
Speaking up, so Commissioner Boyce, you're up on Commissioner Updates.
Well, we're taking the vets on the river. We had skipped the last year, and so we have put together a trip for August 7th.
That's this Sunday.
That's this Sunday. The McNair family's been quite busy, and so have I, but we sent this to the local newspapers, and I've got quite a veterans mail list, and so gets me on the river Sunday, and we're going to have a lot of fun. And so we'll be able to take about 55, and there's already people trying to help a little bit with the fuel cost on this. So if you know anybody that has not been before, boy, take advantage. And you know, at the end of the week, Thursday or Friday, we might be able to invite a few spouses or caregivers if there's plenty of room, but we don't know at this point. You see the phone number for Jerry's Jet Boats there. They're waiting for you to call. 247-4571, area code 541.
How far are you taking? How far up are you going?
Just to Agnes this go around, yeah.
Cougar Lane, okay.
Yeah. Let's see. So I had a really good meeting with 5 different Coast Guard representatives, including the commander from Seattle, on the port. you know, all the aggregate, all the dredging, you know, there's been a lot of concern with the local folks that the Coast Guard's not here as much as we would like, not nearly enough. When you look at them having to travel from either Chetco, Brookings, or North Bend. In reference here, this is Doyle Point, and this is their facility, which I confirm, by the way, is in very good condition. But here's the gravel that they're dealing with, and they draw 7 or 8 feet. And this is what the primary problem is right here. The contractor that's doing the dredging, hired by the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, you know, this is not part of their system here. It was not part of the agreement. And the Coast Guard would have to pay the money, and they're short on funds. And so what has happened, and I'll try and abbreviate this a little bit. What has happened, they have moved to the port. There we go. They have moved to the port because they, on high tide at least, they can get in to the facilities, the docking facilities right here. But when it's low tide, they can't. So not an option here. They trailer the boat from Brookings and launch the boat here at the ramp.
At high tide.
And, I mean, the meeting couldn't have went better except, you know, basically I and Greg Spear from the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers requested that, you know, how can we get this shoal right here in the cove, with what they call the access channel to their dock and what have you, how can we get that dredged? And they basically said, we are in a kind of a catch-22 to where we have to make the port of Gold Beach, the boat basin, our priority right now until we see and get some confidence that this isn't going to fill in every year and give them the same headache. Mm. And they made it clear in a very respectful, very gracious way that other ports up and down the coast, and they weren't just trying to dodge, you know, my request. And I was authorized to represent the Port of Gold Beach, too, because Andy Wright was on the river. He's a new jet boat driver for Jerry's and doing really well. And then Bill McNair, who is the interim port director, is working on this very important infrastructure project that you're quite aware of. So in concluding here, Mr. Chair, what is happening is they want to move back here. They want to protect this facility. They want to get their own dock in. But until they have that assurance, they're going to stay here. The issue, though, is, and here's where Greg Spear from the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, who you have met, he is working very hard to find us the funding so that this can be dredged, and that's going to take a different contractor, different type of equipment, so they can get this dredged, I'm trying to abbreviate here, so they can come in at almost any tide. Of course, the tour boats and the recreational sport fishing boats, they draw a maximum of a foot and a half, as you know.
Oh, yeah, three max, so right, yeah.
We've got to find the money for this right here. I've already been in contact with Senator Merkley's office, Dana Black, his South Coast representatives, 5 counties. And so we're just going to keep pushing to see if we can get the funding to do that dredging, and that'll improve the safety aspect of this entire program.
Court, what is the depth over there at that access channel?
There what?
The depth over there at that Coast Guard.
Well, if you go right by Doyle Point Rock and tide is plenty deep, but boy, the shoal is, even in an average tide, the shoal has got them pinched off so they can't get in there, so they can't get a dock in.
Gotcha.
And a boat in addition. And also, their pilings are not good shape. Mm. And this project right here, if you're interested, the pilings for, they are really acting fast on, you know, getting this system, this whole wall done. The pile driver and that contractor will be here, I think, the end of this month, Bill said. And so that's good news.
Yeah.
The presentations the Coast Guard made were really good, but Spears is an ally, is an advocate for, and he's a big name. And he testified here, you know, what, a month ago, a little over? And again, he's working very hard on this, but he was challenging the Coast Guard, too, to find the money on this. So we haven't give up on this, but, you know, the meeting was very good in clarification, and it was all virtual and lasted about 1 hour and 5 minutes. So that's the update I have there.
Do you have any update on, because every time I go to the port, nothing, that thing is not working.
Which thing?
The clamshell, the big dredge.
Oh, no, they're going now.
Okay.
Yeah, it was Wednesday.
I guess it's just...
See, they did lose 3 days last week.
Something broke?
Yep.
Okay.
It was something to do with one of the barges.
Every time I go down there, I just want to see it grabbing gravel.
You want to see tugs going out.
Yeah. And I've seen it out, you know, I've seen it way like out by Hunter Creek, where they take it out and dump it. But I want to see that clamshell grabbing. And anyway, I think they... Oh, here comes Herzog. We're not going to... Shut it down. Anyway.
I want to read something.
At the last really, really low tide, I was here and took some pictures. I'll send them to you.
This is from Rogue River Siskiyou National Forest Supervisor Merv George. I want to give a quick report on McKinney Fire. And the reason I want to take the time on this, Mr. Chair, is because there's talk of evacuating at some point. Ashland, I don't think that's going to happen, but Wairika is evacuated. It's 56,000 acres. 1 week ago it started. They've lost 100 homes and two lives. Now, that was as of Monday. Thank the good Lord hasn't changed on... There's been no more deaths, but due to the evacuations since Monday.
Surely the acreage is going up because
it's slowing down a little bit, but the tough news is it's zero contained.
Oh.
Zero contained. And so that's not that far away. And like I say, it's got Ashland on a little bit of a concern there. But this is just three short paragraphs from Rogue River Siskiyou National Forest Supervisor Merv George. Hello, everyone. I wanted to share the latest fire intel from the Rogue River Siskiyou National Forest. As you may know, last week we saw a heat wave come through our region. That was followed by lightning storms. That was the biggest I've seen in many years. This is never a good combination when it is the middle of the summer. As of this morning, our crews, with the help of contracted resources and our ODF, Oregon Department of Forestry partners, have been extremely successful in extinguishing all fires on the forest so far this fire season. I want to read that again because they, along with ODF, jump on those fires. And when you have that kind of lightning, there could have been 50 fires. And I think we dodged a bullet there. But the ones that we did have that flared up, I'll finish it. As of morning, our crews, for so far this fire season, to date we have had nearly 20 fires with a handful of acres burned. Interestingly enough, the majority of fires so far have been human caused, 15. So yeah, 75%. I just spoke with our force Fire Management Officer Dan Quinones. When we had our fire management meeting a month ago, this guy was here. I sat with him almost every single morning for 90 days during the Klondike Fire in 2018. He's from Alaska, and Supervisor George hired him, and he is put it out kind of guy. And he shared that we have received a number of lightning strikes on the High Cascades Ranger District up and around the Prospect area last night and early this morning. We are using all technology available, as well as boots on the ground, to see if there are any new smokes to report. They do a lot of that by plane, of course, mm-hmm. too, as you know. And heat sensing. I'm guessing we will see some, and please know we will do our best to get them all out as quickly and as safely as we can. Finally, I want to express my thoughts and prayers to everyone who is being impacted by this year's fire storms. Our neighbors to the south of the Klamath National Forest, where he was supervisor for 6 years, eight years ago, batch of challenging fires. I am hearing many communities are being asked to evacuate, and there have been some homes lost. Deepest condolences to the two civilian fatalities that have been reported as well. We have been assisting all our neighboring jurisdictions the best we can because we realize fires know no jurisdictional boundaries. Please be safe, everyone, as always. I will share more as I learn more. So, you know, his 2 million acres, the five counties, five district rangers, five fire... Forest Service districts, we're in pretty good shape. We didn't get any July fires. Those are the ones that go on forever. So if we get fires now, you know, they usually can be put out by, you know, the middle of September, worst case scenario, depending on the wind. One more quick note on the fire thing. The BLM yesterday, they've raised all fire level on all BLM lands to extreme. It doesn't get any more. It doesn't get any higher on the category than that.
We could see a little smoke last night, a little haze to the south. From Brookings, yeah, just along that coast range there. There was some big thunderheads, which we don't like to see, but there was a little bit of a wispy smoke. Yeah. Yep, you could see it from Brookings, so.
We haven't had the wind this year, so not as bad, but nope. I hope that holds. So I won't read the, this has to do with Oregon State Parks following through with their commitment, their agreement when we traded the 34 acres for the 90 acres of Flores Lake, mm-hmm. That they're going to follow through with their trail planning. And I had a hike with them from around the west end of Flores Lake and up through the BLM section, and it just went really well. I think they had three key people, four actually. And I'm going to have them come make a quick presentation at some point in time. But when we get a little closer to the actual plan that they're going to recommend to Curry County and our board, just really pleased to see the commitment they have and that they're following through. And I was getting a little nervous because that was 4 years ago, and here we are, and no, they're jumping right on it. Really good people. And then also, Mr. Chair, we are looking at, we spent about an hour at McVeigh Park in Brookings, and Juvenile Director Lang was there. She hadn't been there for many years, and we did a serious walk through the, you know, it's I think it's close to 50 acres.
Closer, 23, I think.
Guess again, that's what I originally thought.
Really, that's what Wendy told me, is 23 acres, 23 or 24.
And that was the original, and I could be wrong on this, but there's a section that's not even used. I mean, it's just growing up with alder trees. And so I think when you add that in, and it's funny we talk about the acreage because surprisingly, none of the three reps there with us knew either from Oregon State Parks. And so, but it's a beautiful.
If it's 50, it'd be awesome because that would get us closer to the 90 that we gave away.
Well, we had a little bit of strategy in those days, and but the relationships that we've built with them and the work that they're doing, you know, Dennis Comfort's been almost a lifetime friend of mine. He's retiring, but Chris Havel and Justin Hellberg from Port Orford, and Joe, I got to know pretty well on the walk back, and they're really good state employees, very dedicated. So we'll have more of a report on that. I keep working on housing. Some different things happening there that I think are going to bode well for Curry County through the Eco Northwest, their study, and then the work with Coos County. Stephanie Hadley is doing very well. I don't know where we're going to go with our Curry County Housing Committee. No pessimism, but you know, I'm just starting to think my focus needs to be on, you know, kind of outside Curry County, and but I'll do whatever I got to do to try and solve this problem. It's the number two most important issue to me, and I know it's very important, just behind fire, but I know it's very important to this board as well. Kudos to Economic Development Department. Miranda Plagey did a draft one of the tour of honor between the five counties, the various veterans memorial, and so I'm going to bring that to the board and make sure that they want to continue having her work on that. Right now, I don't think what she's come up with in terms of a brochure does not need a lot of work, but that would be up to the board to decide. And what else? You know, I mentioned the garbage and trash issue last meeting, and I meant to show the board a picture of a burned out motorhome, and perhaps you've seen it.
South Bank?
But, yeah?
Yeah, that one on South Bank of Checo?
Yeah.
Yeah, I saw that.
Yeah, and
but it's been cleaned up, I think, yeah.
You know, it's just the citizens are starting to see, there was a vehicle over here that a couple citizens actually confronted, and because they thought they were getting ready to dump a pickup load of stuff over the hill, and you know, I know you're aware that Douglas County has had that issue, people going way up in the brush and just dumping, and so it's kind of coming, and it's got a lot of people concerned. Certainly I'm concerned. It's part of the reason we live in this beautiful area, and we have promoted code enforcement, and it's going to be a real requirement of a team effort to really push back on this, and it really could, as you know, could cut into our visitor promotion. That's why any improvements we made, you might recall, under the bridge on the south end of Chetco Bar. I still got pictures that Roadmaster Christensen and some of his staff took. It's just beyond appalling what they had to haul out of there. Two or three dump truck loads. In fact, I didn't want to say two or three because it could have been more than that, but it was a disaster. And so we just have to keep pushing back. We have to educate the public. We have to educate ourselves. And we just don't want, we want Curry County to be different. And I think we have the right qualified people to assist in that and keep that focus. And so I have one high school buddy that wants to come in next meeting and say, here's what I'm seeing, and here's what I feel are some of the solutions. So, hey, I think that's all I have. Thank you.
All right. Well, I have nothing, and Chris has nothing, so we are going to adjourn this meeting and go into executive session. Thank you, folks, for visiting. And Matt, as the media, you can stay if you like. Otherwise, get out.
Trying to put this album together as a dredging on the river.
Okay.
I managed with 9 o'clock on July 3rd, lowest tide I've ever seen on the road, and they were dredging, and I got some video of the clamshells.
Good.
If you want any pictures or anything, let me know.
I'm trying to get that sense above of you right now so you can see it.
But if you want any pictures from our end, or
okay, you can shut it down, Eric. Okay. I don't want it there. Thank you.
Why do counties matter? Simple. Counties provide the services we all depend on. If you're concerned about crime, get a regular flu shot, drive to work, take public transportation, or experience a natural disaster in your community, chances are you benefit from county services. That's why counties matter. With America's system of federalism, counties are a key level of government, serving the people directly. So, do you vote? Had a recent hospital stay? Know someone in a nursing home? More reasons why counties matter. There are 3,069 counties across the country, with populations big and small. Most of us live and work in one. Even the nation's capital is considered a county. These county governments ensure that the food you eat in restaurants is safe. They care for the mentally ill, run court systems, build local economies, and operate 911 emergency systems. They manage parks and recreation facilities. And the list goes on. Thing is, counties serve the American people in so many ways, keeping our communities healthy, vibrant, safe, and fiscally sound. That's why counties matter.
everything starts out small. The things that hurt us, they all start from somewhere. The words we say, the things we do, they can grow into something else. What was small and innocent can become big and sometimes scary. All it takes is one comment, one picture, one video for something to catch fire. But a big problem doesn't need a big response. Not at first. Even if we don't know what to say, the eye emoji can be that first step we take. Let's all pledge to take that first small step together and change the world in a big way. I'm a witness, and so are you.
If yours is the next big idea, and you need the right place to fine-tune it, build it, launch it. If you're only your best when you can play more than you work. If inspiration comes from the outside, you belong in Curry County. The westernmost point of the land you love, and the edge between familiar and uncharted. Break the pattern. Be where the airports are as close as the beaches, and industry and recreation never cease to amaze. Dock, dive, and dine in a single day, and never lose your connection. This is the threshold of the West. Live where you can do you, and do it well, at the farthest point from ordinary. Curry County, living on the edge.
There's a shelter pet who wants to meet you. Meet one today. Visit theshelterpetproject.org. Adopt.
One of the things I really appreciate about our entire region is that we embrace who we are, and I think that's what unifies us. Once the timber and fishing industries collapsed, it took us a long time to get back on our feet. People didn't quite grasp the idea that once these jobs left, they weren't going to get other family wage jobs, and it crippled us.
Things were getting really dire. So we just saw that this was an opportunity to maybe look at that public land a little differently and how it could bring more dollars into our region.
The Wild Rivers Coast is so unique because there are more wild and scenic rivers here than anywhere else in the lower 48 states. The scenic beauty is just amazing. There's so many different places to go, from the national forest down to the protected ocean, and it's just a really special place.
I guess I didn't really know how special it was, though, until I moved away to Portland and came back and saw all the potential here.
We're uncrowded, we're unspoiled, and we're a little difficult to get to, but my God, once you come here, you fall in love.
We just thought if we could pull people to come into this Wild Rivers Coast and stay longer and explore a little farther into our backcountry, there was a lot of opportunities for them to experience.
I think our whole future is at stake here. This area is ready to go. We just need to give it a little kick in the butt.
I'm going to be honest. When the Rural Tourism Studio came here, I was skeptical because I didn't see far enough ahead that we actually could collaborate regionally. And I'm pleasantly surprised. It's been amazing.
The Rural Tourism Studios was the first time we were able to come together as a region to talk about the future of our economy.
If we can have a strong tourism economy in this area, it's going to benefit the whole community.
we have to rely on ourselves. And I think through this program, it sort of opened our eyes to what we could do when we work together. Community leaders really focused on three areas: outdoor recreation, food and agricultural tourism, and really building community relationships.
In our area, a lot of the food that's grown all gets shipped away. And so now we're realizing that we can capture some of that local food that's grown here. The Eat Fresh and Local Action Team has hosted a series of networking events bringing together the area growers with the area vendors so that we could have more local food available to the visitors to our area. And now we're seeing more local food in our grocery stores, in our restaurants, and we have a new local food co-op.
We created a farm trail from Bandon to Port Orford. We did 9 U-Pick farms, and it just gained traction, and people loved it.
Langlois is less than 500 people. It's very small. So we have to bring in tourists. And being on the farm trail, even though it's just beginning, has really helped do that. We really want to make it a destination for anybody. My mom and I began Dragonfly Farm just 3 years ago. When I found out that I could grow a seed and turn that into food, it was like, oh my gosh, why wouldn't you do this? I just quit my day job and I just signed the paper to be an official co-owner of the farm. This is what I want to do for the rest of my life and grow with the community.
Out of the Outdoor Recreation Action Team, we came up with a series of maps that show where the best places to go recreate are. We know where we're going to send people now, and we got a great map that shows all the best places to go see.
For us to get a mapping project done to this extent is pretty impressive. We're patting ourselves on the back. I don't know anybody else is, but we're doing it.
From that, we decided that there was some places that needed help. So we came up with a mountain bike plan, and we also worked on designating a state scenic bikeway. The Outdoor Recreation Action Team was also looking at how we can make scuba diving better in this area. So we came up with the idea for a scuba fill station. So now people that want to come and dive in this area, they can dive for multiple days because they can get their tanks filled up again. When I started the Rural Tourism Studio, my business, South Coast Tours, was really small. And now we've grown to about 5 or 6 guides, and we're doing tours all over from Brookings all the way up to Coos Bay.
Overall, tourism is on the rise here. We've had a bang up last 2 years, and it's like a breath of fresh air down here.
My hope for the area is that we still keep that sense of place.
Loving a place to death is a big concern that I have, and it's a balance. We're going to promote tourism, but we want to do it in a sustainable way. One of the biggest reasons that this area has been so successful since the Tourism Studio is the people that are involved. We have a lot of great, motivated, smart people who understand the need to promote tourism in the right way, and it's really all about the people.
When you live in a rural community like we do, from Bandon down to Brookings, and you're strapped for cash, relationships are crucial.
As a community, I think you need to come together and find out what your mission and goals are collectively. Then you can work into smaller groups, knowing that you have the backing of the whole community behind you.
As long as everybody's just super excited about it and passionate about what they're doing and they can work together, then anything's possible.
Own what you have and don't try to be something that you're not. It's gonna be hard. It's gonna take a long time. So roll up your sleeves and just dig in with an open mind.
letters.
Five letters?
Just think about what am I doing right now.
Smile. Smile?
Uh-huh.
This is so easy.
Wildfire, as everyone knows, has emerged as one of the big major issues affecting Oregon and, for that matter, all western states. A real actionable response that's including how do we fight fire, actively managing our forests so that we don't have the fuels out there, and how are we going to protect communities from smoke exposures. The council is really set up to have a comprehensive strategy that's based on action and based on protecting our communities.
The primary focus we as a board have come through with is that in researching the policies for fire management, yes, prescribed fire has its place on the landscape, but not during fire season. We, as a county, passed a proclamation that says once the state fire marshal declares fire season, it'll be nothing but full suppression. And recently took a resolution to the National Association of Counties, essentially says that they support coordination between agencies and local governments for the health, safety, and welfare of the citizens regarding fire, prescribed fire, fire season, anything that affects our citizens.
This is Lily Morgan from Josephine County, and we are at the Rogue Leadership Forum today looking at the best possible partnerships that we can come up with to fight the fire issues and the smoke issues that we're facing in Southwest Oregon. So looking forward to coming up with solutions and the partnerships to get the job done so we don't face what we have the last few years with catastrophic fires and smoke that invades our communities for months to come. So this is a good opportunity, and we hope to be successful in the outcome.
Seeing so many people come together has really been exciting for me, because there's a lot of expertise, there's a lot of resources, and as we attempt to do a shared stewardship approach to keeping people safe, it's really important that we get together. So my name is Merv George Jr., and I'm the Forest Supervisor for the Rogue River Siskiyou National Forest. One of the first things is making sure to get fires out if they're threatening life and property. The second thing that I'm going to focus in on is when it's safe to do so, to put some fire on the landscape when it's cooler and not during fire season, to reduce these same fuels that are giving us so much fits during the fire season.
Bob Horton, I'm the fire chief of Jackson County Fire District 3 in Southern Oregon. The challenges that are facing us in terms of the mega fires and the wildfires that we've been experiencing out in this valley, particularly in the last couple of years, but across the state and across the region, incredibly concerning to us in the fire community, those in our communities in general, our constituents and our patrons are extremely concerned, as they ought to be. Really, the takeaway from the work that's being done now is this is an extraordinary collaboration of dozens on dozens of interested stakeholder groups who are coming together with a common purpose. It's really an inspiring showing of humanity to not only be able to provide for a greater quality of life for our people, but to be strong stewards of our land so that our future for us and generations to come is incredibly bright.
Very pressing issue. It's bearing down on us. Fire season is approaching, and I am really interested in preventing my home and other homes in my community from being impacted by wildfire, specifically from being burnt down. That's my main reason for being involved.
Quite a collaboration of folks. We're here looking for practical solutions to help us unravel some of the issues surrounding wildfires today here in the state of Oregon. And my focus really is on planning for large wildfire events in advance of their occurrence. That way, when they do occur, we can respond more appropriately to those situations.
Well, I just think it's grand of all of the people all over the state have come together today to be concerned about water. It just warms my heart, because I know that they really will leave here today feeling more impressed about the water, because I have told them that we're all born in water. We cannot live without it. It's our job to take care and stop the garbage in the rivers and streams and oceans, because there's life in that water, and it's our job to keep it clean for them. We cannot live on this planet without the animal kingdom. I was in Ohio at the Ohio River with Dr. Emoto, the Japanese scientist who had proven water could hear. He and I stood on the riverbank blessing the Ohio River that they had us come to do. And I prayed that God has still kept the river good for them over there. We were taught when we were little that prayer works. You too will remember your prayers because they work. It has nothing to do with religion or church.
What draws you to the Oregon coast? Is it the green and blue surf on a brilliant sunny day? Or angry, boiling waves during a raging winter storm? Do you prefer quiet coves or powerful breakers churning the sand? How about sand castles? Do you come for the rising tide or the setting sun? To marvel at whales gliding through the sea or flying in the sky? Reasons to travel the Pacific Coast Scenic Byway are as far-reaching as your imagination. This is a spectacular part of Oregon that traces the entire coastline along Highway 101, guiding you to the sea and away again, to coastal towns big and small, lowland marshes, and breathtaking overlooks. It's a long byway stretching from the mouth of the Columbia River to the California border, 363 miles in all, of some of the most unblemished, awe-inspiring seascapes you'll find anywhere. In addition to its designation as a scenic byway, Highway 101 in Oregon also has been selected as an all-American road. That means when you come here, you will experience one of only 31 roads considered to be the best of the best in America.
You know, when people come to the Oregon coast, they're really astonished how beautiful it is. And what separates it from many of the other places in North America that are coastal is how undeveloped it is. And that's because Oregon had a very far-sighted land use program back in the 1970s. We have all these wonderful state parks along the scenic byway that are perfect places to stop and enjoy nature in a relatively unspoiled way.
From the north, you begin in Astoria, the first permanent European settlement in the Pacific Northwest. It's a genuine maritime community with ship traffic from around the world seeking harbor up the Columbia. The official State Maritime Museum of Oregon sits here on the river. Beautiful Victorian houses dot the hillside. And standing 600 feet above sea level is the 125-foot Astoria Column. It features a hand-painted spiral frieze that would stretch over 500 feet if unwound. Heading south, you'll find the community of Seaside, a popular vacation spot that offers miles of public beaches, an oceanfront promenade, and a downtown core packed with restaurants, shops, and even a beach-type arcade. Cannon Beach is home to one of Oregon's most photographed natural wonders, Haystack Rock. Get your shots from the beach, or take a short drive up to Ecola State Park and look down on this 235-foot work of art. The picturesque small town is filled with art galleries, shops, and cafes. Ready for more? 10 miles to the south, this is the view from Cape Falcon. You're 700 feet above the Pacific. Here, the Pacific Coast Byway has been carved out of Neocone Mountain and held in place by stone walls built in the 1930s by craftsmen in the Civilian Conservation Corps. Upon descending the mountain, the highway drifts inward around Tillamook Bay to Tillamook, the unofficial dairy capital of Oregon. The verdant valley of dairy farms in this area produces 25 million gallons of milk annually. Much of that is processed into natural cheddar cheese. And near more than 800 miles of navigable waters, Tillamook is a crossroads for North Coast recreation. From here, you owe it to yourself to veer off Highway 101 to explore the Three Cape Scenic Loop. This drive places you right at the beach, beginning with Cape Mears, home to the shortest lighthouse in Oregon. 9 lighthouses stand sentinel along Oregon's coastline. They're monuments to our maritime heritage. towering links to the past and as much a part of the rugged Oregon coastal landscape as any offshore monolith. The Cape Mears Lighthouse was first illuminated in 1890. Oregon's oldest lighthouse is at Cape Blanco, the westernmost point in the state. It was commissioned in 1870 to aid shipping generated by gold mining and the lumber industry. The 93-foot-high Yaquina Head Lighthouse is the tallest in Oregon. Today, its automated light continues to aid navigation at the entrance to Yaquina Bay. Many of the lighthouses are open to the public. Most happen to be excellent places to view nesting seabirds and offshore sea life. Tide pools, those rocky areas between high and low tides, support unique and diverse plants and animals. Vast amounts of colorful, otherworldly creatures wait to be discovered. But walk cautiously. These organisms are tough enough to withstand the pounding surf, but are utterly vulnerable to human activity. Wildlife and sea life abound on the coast.
There are six national wildlife refuges along the Oregon coast. The Pacific Coast Scenic Byway bisects these refuges or goes alongside them. It provides you the opportunity to see a wide variety of abundant wildlife, including seabirds, seals and sea lions, deer and elk, and many other wildlife.
Cape Kiwanda lies at the southern end of the Three Capes Scenic Loop, near the town of Pacific City. Here you'll find a second Haystack Rock on the byway. Hike up the dune to marvel at stunning views of sandstone formations as they turn yellow, gold, or even red in the changing sunlight. If your timing is right, you'll spot one or two of the dory fleet sprint onto the beach after a day of fishing. How's this for a dinner setting? Restaurants along the Pacific Coast Scenic Byway accommodate just about any taste. Many serve an ocean view with every meal. Up and down the coast, you'll find seafood, of course, but don't limit yourself just because you're by the water. The Central Coast begins around Lincoln City, which is one of the larger communities on the byway. It has a reputation for being windy and was recognized by Kite Lines magazine as the best place to fly a kite in North America. It was incorporated from several small towns and as a result offers a sandy beach that is 7.5 miles long. A number of small state parks lie nestled along the ocean between Lincoln City and Newport. Stop, get out of your car, and take in the commanding views that are there, right next to your All-American Road. Depot Bay boasts the world's smallest navigable harbor, 6 square acres in all. A seawall runs the length of the downtown, so everywhere you go, you're rewarded with a dramatic view of the Pacific. It's considered Oregon's whale-watching capital, with thousands making their way past Oregon each fall and spring. Fishing and whale-watching excursions regularly set sail from this little harbor. Leaving Depot Bay, you'll soon find yourself at Cape Foulweather, a basalt outcropping that looms 500 feet above the water. It was here, in 1778, British Captain James Cook first sighted the mainland of North America on the Pacific coast. A fierce storm that almost put an end to his expedition earned this rugged stretch of coastline its name. Coastal weather can change by the hour. You will find a lot of wet days, but rain can become blue sky with white clouds in an afternoon. Mist kissing the headlands burns away, or storms can last for days. Some people come for those storms. Whether you find sunbursts of happiness or cloud cover like a quilt, there's always a reason to come back. Like Lincoln City, Newport is one of the larger towns on the byway. The historic bayfront on the north side of Yaquina Bay hosts one of Oregon's largest commercial fishing fleets. It has a busy, genuine working waterfront feel, with fish plants and boats coming and going from as far away as Alaska. On the south side of the bay is the Oregon Coast Aquarium. Share waters beneath the ocean with sharks and rays. And don't miss the sea otters at mealtime.
Now, all four of our otters were rescued otters. They were found out in the wild.
For the next 50 miles, your trip along Highway 101 hugs the coast. Many more state parks offer opportunities to stop and take in outstanding vistas, crashing waves, and offshore rock formations. Two small towns of note are Waldport and Yahats. Waldport sits on Alsea Bay, where fishing, clamming, and crabbing are popular. The 40-mile stretch south of Waldport marks steep headlands, jagged volcanic outcrops, and jaw-dropping scenery, the rugged edge of the Oregon coast. Yahats is a quiet, unhurried artist town just a couple of miles north of Cape Perpetua. Drive to the top of this bluff and you'll be 800 feet above the water. On a clear day, you can see 70 miles of Oregon coastline. Drive past Hasita Head Lighthouse to the Sea Lion Caves. A quick elevator ride 200 feet down puts you in America's largest sea cave, the year-round home of wild stellar sea lions. Rugged cliffs give way to graceful beaches as you approach Florence. In the spring, be on the lookout for wild rhododendrons along the roadsides. Similar to Newport, you'll find an historic Old Town commercial district along the Siuslaw River. Florence is the gateway to the Oregon Dunes National Recreation Area, a 47-mile sandbox of wind-sculpted sand dunes towering 500 feet above sea level. These are the largest expanse of coastal sand dunes in North America. Reedsport is at the center of the Oregon Dunes, but you can do more than ride a dune buggy or motorcycle. A short 3 miles east of town on Highway 38, more than 100 Roosevelt elk reside at the Dean Creek Elk Viewing Area. Early mornings or just before dusk are the best times to photograph the herd. Paying homage to Oregon's timber heritage, Reedsport hosts an annual chainsaw sculpting championship, a time to watch three-dimensional artwork come to life right before your eyes. Mountains of sand continue at Winchester Bay. You'll also find an active marina here. It's a great place to try your hand at crabbing or take a charter for salmon or bottom fishing. The dunes end and you enter the coast's largest urban area at Coos Bay. It has the deepest natural harbor between Seattle and San Francisco. Foreign vessels sail under the massive McCullough Bridge. You may have noticed, dotted along the Pacific Coast Scenic Byway, are many beautiful and iconic bridges. The Megler Bridge in Astoria, Yaquina Bay Bridge in Newport, Alsea Bay Bridge in Waldport, Siuslaw River Bridge in Florence, and the magnificent McCullough Bridge in Coos Bay are works of art in their own right. Charleston is slightly off the byway at the mouth of the bay. It was once an old waterfront fishing village and has become a commercial and sport fishing center. From here, the Charleston to Bandon tour route offers another side trip off the byway. It's a wonderful way to explore a variety of natural Pacific Coast beauty in a number of settings: beaches, vistas, gardens, and more. Giant sea stacks, a tiny lighthouse, and an old town await you in Bandon. Do you like to golf? This remote area on the Oregon coast has not one, but three of the most stunning and challenging golf courses in the world. As you drive south of town, look for brilliant red bogs in the fall. You're passing through the cranberry capital of Oregon. After a trek through forests and farmlands, you'll reach Port Orford. The wild coast has begun. You're in the most westerly city in the continental United States, and you've reached some of the most awesome scenery on the byway. Here you can watch a fishing fleet launched by crane in one of only six dolly ports in the world. Port Orford covers less than 2 square miles. It's similar to many communities that call this all-American road home. Small in size, still with a lot to offer. Like Manzanita, with a vibrant business district and beautiful setting at the base of Neocone Mountain. You can board a fishing charter out of Garibaldi, swim in freshwater lakes near Dune City, catch world-class windsurfing at Pistol River. There's little development from Port Orford to Gold Beach, outlet for the renowned Rogue River. Feel like going for a ride? Jet boat excursions run from May into October up this wild and scenic river. Or maybe a midday walk on an uncrowded beach is more your speed. The last dozen miles of the Pacific Coast Byway leading into Brookings save some of the best for last. Treat yourself to frequent stops along the Samuel H. Boardman Scenic Corridor. Short hikes reward you with the best views in this shining stretch of coastline. Walk, relax, and be amazed along the coves in the crashing surf. The world's northernmost redwood grove is 8 miles from the mouth of the Chetco River in Brookings. So, you've toured nature's finest art museum. You've dined elegantly, hung out with sea lions, unwound like you wish you could every day. What else is there to do? Step back in history near Astoria. Ride a horse along the waves near Florence. pet a baby tiger near Bandon. Hike a trail, sample gourmet cheese, eat fresh caught crab, watch a sunset.
When you come to the Oregon coast and walk on the beaches or go to the headlands and go to the small coastal towns, you really can commune with nature and you don't have huge numbers of people, but you're also able to take in one of America's last great unspoiled seascapes.
So what draws you to the Oregon coast? What favorite places lure you back again and again? Each visit is different. The ocean, the sky, the light, and the experience always continue to amaze. Shouldn't you be there?
There's something about having land and sea. Never having to choose between digging in or looking out. Here, you can go where the spirit or the wind moves you. To the tops of the trees, along secluded beaches, or into more wild and scenic rivers than anywhere else in the western United States. We're the closest place to the sunset while still keeping your feet dry, and a destination where anyone can begin. We share more than we keep, so you can see more than you imagined. This is a place you have to touch, hold, and feel to believe. The entire shoreline of the West Coast's best coast is open to you. And playgrounds made of forests are waiting for you. Escape to Curry County and don't leave anything out.
Roadway departure fatalities are a serious and often preventable problem in the United States. The Federal Highway Administration reports that 54% of all highway fatalities are caused by drivers leaving their lane of travel. The Oregon Department of Transportation is taking a proactive approach to reduce this kind of tragedy by implementing a centerline and shoulder rumble strip program.
Rumble strips are one of the most low-cost, cost-effective countermeasures that we can apply across the system.
Rumble strips are grooved patterns on the roadway that make a rumbling sound and a physical vibration, immediately warning inattentive drivers that they're leaving their driving lane. Rumble strips allow drivers to self-correct and avoid an accident.
About 67% of fatal crashes in Oregon are road departure crashes, which are a vehicle can leave the lane to the right and hit a ditch or a rock or a tree, something like that, or cross over the center line to the left and get in a head-on collision or a sideswipe meeting type crash.
Over an 8-year period, ODOT engineers studied segments of 16 different highways and concluded that rumble strips are highly effective at reducing lane departures.
We did a before and after crash analysis to find that we have reduced head-on fatalities by 40% with the installation of centerline rumble strips.
We've been trying to find a way to deal with a problem that seems to be increasing over the last 10 or 15 years with our drivers, and that's distracted driving. And there's a lot of things that cause distracted driving. All these distractions are things that make people take their attention away from where it should be.
Comparisons between other available safety features like guardrail and concrete barriers show that shoulder and centerline rumble strips are the most cost-effective safety treatment available.
We're finding that those are very effective in trying to make sure that when you do make that mistake, it's not the last mistake you make. They help bring your attention back to the driving task and bring you back to where you should be, focusing on being in the middle of your lane and being safe.
ODOT makes a conscious effort to use a
bike-friendly rumble strip design where possible, and installs 12-foot bike gaps every 48 feet of rumble strip. ODOT understands that rumble strips create a noise that can be disruptive for people who live near rural highways, and we're trying to address these concerns with different approaches.
For the noise, we're looking at some new designs. We're hoping that the new design rumble strip will be just as effective at saving people from making an error and much quieter, on the order of 10 times as quiet. And we are actually going to be installing our first full set of these style of rumble strips along 205 this summer.
So we recognize that noise is a concern, but one of the things I like to tell people is whenever you hear the sound of a rumble strip, it could be the sound of the life being saved of one of your loved ones.
Rumble strips are proven to save lives. The Oregon Department of Transportation is taking the lead in implementing the Sound of Safety.
Hi there, I'm Patrick Priest, Executive Director at CIS. And I really enjoy coming every year to this conference because CIS, we are all about counties. We are owned by counties. We were formed by the AOC. This is a great occasion for us to meet everybody in one place and learn what's important to the counties all across Oregon.
It's the networking. I mean, we learn a lot about the different issues that counties deal with, but it's networking with other commissioners, getting ideas on how they handle situations that is the most helpful for me.
I love my job. It actually matters to me on a daily basis. I used to do a lot of charity, and you know, in commissioning in Deschutes County, you can make a serious difference. Lots of things have happened since I've been in office, and I feel like it's important to represent the people. I grew up in Eastern Oregon, and I love the residents of Eastern Oregon. The architect of our first house actually had Doris Day as a dear friend and a client, and he would bring Doris Day up the mountains in Malibu to our house as it was being built.
This is my fourth conference at AOC. My favorite part is the fellowship with other commissioners and coming up with solutions with common situations and with commissioners from around the state to best serve our people. My favorite part about being a commissioner in Josephine County is the people that we work with. We live in the most beautiful place, but we have the most beautiful people. They are talented, artistic, caring. We have such a high level of philanthropy and just caring for our fellow citizens, and it's the best place in all of Oregon.
Hi, I'm Commissioner Martha Schrader from Clackamas County, Oregon. I'm the current president of the Association of Oregon Counties. Oh my goodness, I've been president for 1 year, but I've been a member of the Association of Oregon Counties since 2003. So one of the reasons I really wanted to be president and I've enjoyed it so much is because I get to know everybody across the state, all the commissioners, and I've been from one end of the state to the other, visiting with them, talking with them, and really getting an idea of how we differ, but more importantly, what our similarities are and what we can do with one another to move forward with good county government.
I've been coming to AOC now for 4 years. My favorite part of serving as commissioner is trying to bring positive effects for our community and our county.
This is my second year at AOC, and the camaraderie that I've found in my Eastern Oregon partners and just the camaraderie of AOC has really blessed my life.
My name is Court Boyce, Curry County Commissioner. This is a collection of people, county commissioners, public officials, well attended from all over the state. You know, I have the privilege of working with a very diverse group of people, different ages, different backgrounds, different interests, but they're all teaming up to solve the problems of our county. And it's just really a pleasure to be able to be connected with and working with those people. And better days, good days ahead for our county and our citizens.
Hi, I'm Joe Tobolskis. This is my third AOC convention, and my favorite part is the networking with the people. And the breakout sessions are kind of good because it gives me something to focus on, a goal where I want the county to be in 5 years when my term is up.
Hi, I'm Tillamook County Commissioner Dave Yamamoto. Our county college class was probably the best county college class ever at AOC. It was the largest at over 33 members. When you look at the legislature and the power that the major metropolitan areas have, the rural counties are oftentimes left out of those conversations. AOC really does a terrific job of representing rural counties and rural interests, and we wouldn't have the impact that we do in Oregon without AOC.
My name is Joe Burney, Lane County Commissioner from Springfield. My favorite part is eating good food. My second favorite part is meeting with other commissioners, seeing what they're thinking, comparing solutions to problems, learning how nonpartisan solutions really are, and getting ideas.
Yes.
Hi, my name is Derek DeGroot, Klamath County Commissioner. And
so I'm running for second vice president of the Association of Oregon Counties. I believe that our association is perfectly poised to solve problems and bring solutions to Oregon politics and communicate with the legislature about the diversity of Oregon.
I'm Jay Bozovich, and I'm a Lane County Commissioner. And so I've been a commissioner for about 8 years and 11 months. And my favorite part about being a commissioner is this job is different every day.
Hi, my name is Alex Tardif, and I'm a commissioner for Columbia County and currently serving as AOC treasurer in my second year. And the thing I enjoy most about AOC and being the treasurer is the ability to bring 36 counties together to build a state vision to move our state forward into the future while building a livable, workable community that we all want to enjoy.
Sign that doesn't have a rider on it, so we take our first step at this closest speed limit of.
Harley Bills that are seeing more than their share of curvy roads these days. Their job is to drive every stretch of highway in Region 1 several times. All this driving back and forth.
The old limits were set back in the 1930s and 40s and were changed very little until just recently. So now our limits are taking into account newer vehicles, a little bit more aggressive driving style. And so those limits are going up.
And going up in a big way. This is Eric Leeming, a traffic devices engineer with ODOT. He's driving an ordinary car with some extraordinary tech on board, a GPS device that records data as he maneuvers every curve in the road. Back at his office, Eric can upload the data recorded in the car, and special software determines exactly the right speed for every curve every time. Most speeds will increase by 5 to 10 miles per hour. But in some special cases, it's much higher.
The state has a deadline of 2019 from the Federal Highway Administration. But with 8,000 miles of roads to investigate and potentially thousands of signs to change, they're not wasting any time. They're getting out there right now.
Now we're going to W113.
About 800 signs along this section.
That's a lot of signs.
It's a lot of signs.
Okay.
35 mile an hour corner, you should be taking it at 35 miles an hour.
Why do counties matter? Simple. Counties provide the services we all depend on. If you're concerned about crime, get a regular flu shot, drive to work, take public transportation, or experience a natural disaster in your community, chances are you benefit from county services. That's why counties matter. With America's system of federalism, counties are a key level of government, serving the people directly. So, do you vote? Had a recent hospital stay? Know someone in a nursing home? More reasons why counties matter. There are 3,069 counties across the country, with populations big and small. Most of us live and work in one. Even the nation's capital is considered a county. These county governments ensure that the food you eat in restaurants is safe. They care for the mentally ill, run court systems, build local economies, and operate 911 emergency systems. They manage parks and recreation facilities. And the list goes on. Thing is, counties serve the American people in so many ways. Keeping our communities healthy, vibrant, safe, and fiscally sound. That's why counties matter.
Well, we're here with Commissioner Colleen Roberts for the monthly meeting of the ONC board, which Colleen sits on. Colleen, why don't you tell our audience a little bit about your mission and what you guys discuss at these monthly meetings?
Sure. Well, our ONC board is of the 18 counties in Oregon that have the ONC lands on their BLM. Federal lands. And we discuss everything about these lands. The ONC Act of 1937 is our primary focus, how the decisions that these lands get managed, do they match up with the congressional mandate of the ONC Act, and how we can better educate and help administer the care of these lands for the health and safety and welfare of the citizens that we represent.
I would imagine you discuss things like how many board feet can be taken out of the forest in different areas. Are these things that come up each month?
Yes. Well, harvest timber management is a big part of our conversation, as is lately the fire issues.
We're here today with Commissioner Dan DeYoung of Josephine County. Dan, you have an important role on the ONC Lands Board. And we're here in beautiful Gold Beach, Oregon, discussing the monthly matters of ONC. What was your main focus at this meeting?
Today we had a really good sit down with two representatives for the BLM. And there's costs that we work with BLM because actually the ONC lands are on BLM lands, and that's our concern. Mainly the ONC Board of Directors, which is a membership from all 18 counties. We always meet, I think it's bi-monthly, and then we have an annual meeting, and it's basically to discuss what the sign says, forest health, jobs, and county services, that the money coming from the sale of timber on ONC lands goes through the federal government. They take their share out of it and then return it back to the counties to be used for basically jobs, county services, a lot of county services, such as law enforcement, schools. There's just an awful lot of things that these individual counties can use the money for. But it's from the sale of timber on the ONC land. ONC lands goes way back to 1937 with the ONC, 1937 ONC Congressional Act, and the ONC Act of 1937. We're just trying to get back to the actual verbiage and the language that's in that act. It's surprising to us how we can ignore a congressional act. That remains to be answered by the federal government, but that's what we want to get back to.
Hi there. I'm Tillamook County Commissioner Dave Yamamoto. I'm a member of the ONC Board and also the chair of the Council of Forest Trust Land Counties. And in Tillamook County, it's very important that we consider natural resource-based economies. So in Tillamook County, we have lots of dairy. I'm sure you're familiar with Tillamook Creamery, but also
great
lots
cheese.
Of state and federal timberlands.
Okay.
When it comes to federal timberlands in particular, everyone thinks that we're looking at timber revenue. And that's very important. But one side of the coin that people don't consider are the family wage jobs that come with all timber. It's not just the timber receipts that we get. These are family wage jobs. These are fully benefited jobs. Whereas on the tourism side, the income is about a third of what we would consider a family wage job. And there are also no benefits with those. So timber receipts are very important, but it's the family wage jobs that they create at the same time, which are very important to counties like Tillamook.
Perfect. Keeping it real for families in
Absolutely.
Tillamook County.
Absolutely.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Yamamoto.
Thank you very much.
All right. We are here with County Commissioner Bob Main from Coos County, Oregon. And we've had the monthly meeting of ONC lands here. And Mr. Main, Commissioner Main, I should say, tell us what your role is, Bob, on the ONC lands board.
I am the vice president of the ONC Association of Oregon Sea Counties.
Okay.
Consists of 18 ONC counties, Western Oregon counties.
Okay.
And we make sure that the counties receive their payments from those ONC lands that Congress designated for the sole purpose of those 18 ONC counties. For no other reason, Congress decided that when they took back the lands and took them off the tax roll, that the county should benefit from the harvest of those lands. Without that, the tax rates, like in my county, would be 2 to 3 times higher.
Oh, okay. So you help keep the tax rates down in your county by utilizing
sure.
the full function of this congressional
Absolutely.
Act.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Okay, wonderful.
Thank you.
Well, thank you for your service.
Thank you.
Thank you. We are here with Oregon Curry County Commissioner Court Boyce. Thank you so much for taking a moment to speak with us.
Well, thank you. With the natural resource base that this state has, I've spending better than half of my time as a county commissioner on those issues, fire management, public lands management, certainly natural resources, all of those. And so I'm often reminded that 250 years ago, the generations that came before us, when they got here to Oregon, include Northern California, they found the greatest forest in all of North America that produce the greatest watersheds, that produce the most pristine rivers, that give us the most the highest quality of salmon or steelhead runs, arguably on the planet.
Yeah, I just picked her up. We should be there in 20 minutes.
Who is it? Oh, it's him. Where is he?
I know. Yeah, I know.
I love walking. It's what I do. So who better to share some tips to help keep your walk safe? Wait for the signal. Take in the sights and smells till you get the go-ahead to cross. Use intersections to cross, but when you can't, remember your training. Always look left, right, left. Show you want to cross and wait for all lanes of traffic to stop. And make eye contact so you know the driver sees you. Hi there. Good human. You get a treat when we get home.
My name is Judy Miles, and I'm the program director for Ready, Set, Learn.
Ready, Set, Learn is a program that Carol Hackerell and I developed several years ago, coming from a site council meeting at our local school district. We were problem solving, something we could do to just help students have a better transition into the school system from the community and from their preschool classrooms. So Ready, Set, Learn was developed, and the focus of it is for children to just have an opportunity to come to the place that they'll be going to school and get comfortable with the setting. They get to have lunch and breakfast in the cafeteria and see how it works and how food is going to occur in their school. They also get to see the classrooms and meet some of the staff that they'll be seeing at the school when they start kindergarten in the fall. We provide transportation for them so that the students who live a further distance away still have access to the program and can still come and attend. And they also get to ride the school bus and find out what that is like when they're going to start school the following fall.
I'm Carol Hackerell, and I've worked with the Ready, Set, Learn program for 4 years. I started it with Judy Miles in response to recognizing that a lot of kids come into kindergarten without a whole lot of familiarity with what the K-12 school is like. We came up with the idea for this program and worked with the superintendent at that time to build something that was available to the community at no charge, to come in, have a chance to practice school skills, get familiar with school staff and school routines, keep the chance to keep learning over the summer and get ready so that when you come into school, you are comfortable and familiar and happy with your surroundings and the teachers and the chance to learn. We're open to any child in the grades that we serve, which right now is K-3, and we have a lot of children coming from Bandon as well as from the local community. During the Ready, Set, Learn program, kids come in and we start the day with a breakfast, free breakfast. And then they come into the classroom and spend a little time together as a community and during circle time. And then they rotate through a series of activities which are all designed to be fun and engaging for them and to help them get some learning, solidify some learning that will give them a leg up on the next school year.
America's 3,069 county governments provide fundamental services for building healthy, safe, and vibrant communities. We are an intergovernmental partner, implementing federal and state policies at the local level, often under strict rules and funding constraints. County governments, through the National Association of Counties, engage federal policymakers on a range of issues like transportation, infrastructure, healthcare, public safety, and public lands management. All of these issues are vital to our nation's quality of life and our long-term prosperity. Decisions made by the White House, Congress, and federal courts have a major cascading impact on our ability to lead our communities and pursue a better future. Let's look at why federal policies matter to county government and why county government matters to America. Counties provide vital services that keep our communities thriving and secure. We own and maintain 45% of roads and 4 out of 10 bridges. We own more than a third of the airports and hundreds of hospitals and thousands of courthouses, jails, 911 call centers, and libraries. We play a critical role during emergencies like hurricanes, floods, and snowstorms. What if you called 911 and no one answered? What if you couldn't reach your medical facility because roads and bridges were in disrepair or never built? County governments are an indispensable part of the infrastructure and services that keep residents safe and connected. But with very limited revenue options under most state constitutions and laws, counties must make every penny count in order to fulfill federal and state mandates and required responsibilities. Nothing is more basic in our society than essential public facilities like schools, hospitals, airports, jails, bridges, and other infrastructure. Yet proposals have surfaced to eliminate or scale back tax-exempt municipal bonds. For over a century, municipal bonds have been the lifeblood for our nation's public infrastructure, helping finance more than $3.7 trillion in essential projects. If tax-exempt municipal bonds were eliminated or scaled back, county governments and our residents would face billions in new costs when financing vital facilities. Additionally, counties rely on MAP 21 and the Federal Highway Trust Fund to complement local transportation financing resources. With growing demands and mounting costs, we need a reliable federal partner to invest with us in our nation's economic growth and competitiveness. We need a long-term legislative solution with increased funding to ensure continued success in operating our nation's transportation system. Counties face further revenue losses each year because billions of dollars in e-commerce sales tax revenue isn't collected. The Marketplace Fairness Act would enable states and localities to collect existing, already owed taxes. It would also level the playing field between many internet retailers who don't collect sales taxes and Main Street businesses that do. County governments provide support services to federal public lands, touching 700 million annual visitors. We lead search and rescue operations, fight fires, protect the public's health, and maintain roads. Federal lands cover nearly one-third of the U.S. and impact 69% of counties. Because federal land is exempt from local property taxes, counties depend on PILT, the Payment in Lieu of Taxes program, to provide essential services. The Secure Rural Schools program provides assistance to rural counties and school districts affected by the decline in revenue from timber harvests on federal land. Decisions to cut or delay funding both programs undermine our ability to provide services and maintain public lands. Our intergovernmental partnerships don't end with legislation because counties also implement and comply with federal and state regulations. When considering environmental protections, we know our communities and care deeply about the environment. We need a stronger voice in shaping common sense regulations that protect communities while also promoting economic growth. This is why NACO secured significant improvements to FEMA's flood insurance program and is pushing back on the waters of the U.S. proposed rule. Our message: federal policies matter to county government, and county government matters to America. Every level of government must work together to shape policies that improve the quality of life for all Americans. Whether it's building and maintaining infrastructure, providing essential services, or fostering economic growth, counties are on the front line serving their citizens. NACO stands ready to work with the administration and Congress to make our nation's communities healthier, safer, and more vibrant places to live and work.
Did you see Allison at lunch today? I'm gonna text Allison.
Hey, hold up, Matt's calling me. Hey, we got the food and we're on our way right now. Hey, who's coming, bro?
Counties matter. Counties serve nearly every American every day. Urban, suburban, and rural, counties work with states, the federal government, and other public and private partners to keep our communities healthy, vibrant, and safe. Whether you're commuting to work or shipping goods around the globe, counties matter. Counties own and maintain 45% of the nation's roads and 4 out of 10 bridges. And we're involved in nearly a third of public airports and transit systems. Counties matter when Americans need us the most. Counties matter because we support smart, fair, and effective criminal justice systems. We help fund police and sheriff's departments. We own and operate local jails, 911 call centers, and mental health facilities. Counties create healthy communities. We invest more than $80 billion in hospitals and medical services each year. Counties matter because we invest in the lives of residents of all ages, improving their quality of life where they live and work. Counties are the building blocks of state, regional, and national economies. We support housing, recreation, and economic development. And we do so much more. From issuing birth certificates to administering elections, counties employ more than 3.5 million people. In total, we invest more than $500 billion in our residents and our communities every year. Counties provide essential services we all depend on every day. That's why counties matter.
When a large forest fire breaks out, potentially threatening lives, homes, wildlife, and thousands of acres of forest land, the news coverage is immediate and consistent. Interviews with homeowners, firefighters, medical aid providers, and others continues nonstop until the fire is sufficiently contained. At that point, the cameras are turned off, the interviews are over, and it's on to the next event. Images of catastrophic wildfire, with its ferocity and devastating impact on the land, hold the interest and attention of the public. However, there is an equally important story occurring on that same landscape after the fire is contained, mopped up, and finally declared out that the public seldom sees. The frequency and size of these mega fires on federal forest land has increased significantly over the last few decades. All too often, what is left in their wake is a vast sea of dead, charred trees. Unfortunately, because of a maze of confusing and often contradictory rules and regulations, very little rehabilitation or reforestation occurs after these fires. The result of this neglect, in many cases, is as devastating as the fire itself. Here's why. Even in the hottest, severe fires, most of the dead trees remain standing. The wood not damaged by the fire, still suitable and valuable for lumber. But as the insects move in, within months, the dead and dying trees begin to deteriorate and decompose. Eventually, all of the economic value is lost. What is not removed will decay, add fuel to an even greater future fire threat, and in the process, release the greenhouse gases that the trees gathered and stored during the centuries they were alive. When all of the trees across the tens of thousands of acres burned in each of these megafires are left to rot, millions of tons of destructive greenhouse gases are released into the upper atmosphere. These are the same volatile organic compounds that have been identified as some of the most damaging elements we can put into our air. In contrast, trees harvested soon after the fire is out drive the economic engine that employs people, provides revenue for the critical restoration and reforestation, and can provide dollars for local government services such as schools, public safety, health and social services, libraries, and good roads. When the harvested trees are made into lumber for homes, construction, and furniture, the carbon remains in storage instead of going up into the atmosphere. Dead and dying timber becomes a magnet for insect infestation. These infestations can be so large that they do not end with the burned forest, but progress into the surrounding green forest, killing even more trees, which then become even more fodder for the next fire. In absence of prompt active management and reforestation, invasive brush can dominate the landscape. That brush can retard and even prohibit the growth of the new forest and compound the fuel load for a future fire. When that fire does occur, the dense brush and dead, fallen trees on the ground create a firestorm, burning hotter and even more damaging to the soil than the first fire. These damaged soils can repel water, lack the nutrients and organic matter needed by seedlings, and hinder the ability of new trees to grow. While megafires can be so devastating, not all fires are bad. When the conditions are right, fire has been used for decades as an effective way to reduce fuels on the forest floor, burn back brush and dead grass to stimulate the new growth desired by wildlife, thinning out the younger, overstocked areas of our forests, and maintain the fire resiliency we seek. Controlled burning can be a powerful and useful tool, used in the right places, at the right time, by the professionals we charge with managing these forests. The desired result is to lessen the potential for the large, devastating megafires we have been experiencing these past few decades. Recovery after megafires is not only possible, but can greatly expedite the restoration and creation of all of the benefits of a healthy forest ecosystem. One fine example is Oregon's Tillamook State Forest. After repeated massive fires in the mid-20th century, state, county government, private companies, and even school children worked together to restore and replant over 500 square miles of burned-over landscape. As a result of those efforts, today we have prime fish and wildlife habitat for salmon, trout, elk, and owls, plus camping, hiking and biking trails, healthy growing forests that gather and store carbon, and sustainable timber harvest that supports local economies, funds schools and local governments, and supports thousands of family-wage jobs across the region. Without the vision of those state and local leaders just a few decades ago, very little, if any of this, would be possible today. Nearly every year for the past 20 years, we have watched millions of acres of our public forests burned by megafires. We spend hundreds of millions, even billions of dollars fighting them. Yet when the fire is out, a mere fraction of the killed trees and lost value is ever recovered, with little or no effort to restore the burned landscape. What can you do? Contact your elected federal, state, and local officials. Tell them these federal lands and once treasured forests are too valuable to simply walk away. Future generations are depending upon you to take action. For more information, visit us on Facebook at Communities for Healthy Forests.
Why do counties matter? Simple. Counties provide the services we all depend on. If you're concerned about crime, get a regular flu shot. Drive to work. Take public transportation. Or experience a natural disaster in your community. Chances are, you benefit from county services. That's why counties matter. With America's system of federalism, counties are a key level of government, serving the people directly. So, do you vote? Had a recent hospital stay? Know someone in a nursing home? More reasons why counties matter. There are 3,069 counties across the country, with populations big and small. Most of us live and work in one. Even the nation's capital is considered a county. These county governments ensure that the food you eat in restaurants is safe. They care for the mentally ill, run court systems, build local economies, and operate 911 emergency systems. They manage parks and recreation facilities, and the list goes on. Thing is, counties serve the American people in so many ways, keeping our communities healthy, vibrant, safe, and fiscally sound. That's why counties matter.
Everything starts out small. The things that hurt us, they all start from somewhere. The words we say, the things we do, they can grow into something else. What was small and innocent can become big and sometimes scary. All it takes is one comment, one picture, one video for something to catch fire. But a big problem doesn't need a big response. Not at first. Even if we don't know what to say, the eye emoji can be that first step we take. Let's all pledge to take that first small step together and change the world in a big way. I'm a witness, and so are you.
If yours is the next big idea, and you need the right place to fine-tune it, build it, launch it, if you're only your best when you can play more than you work, if inspiration comes from the outside, you belong in Curry County.
All right, welcome back, everybody. We are we're just coming out of executive session, and we have directed staff to work as directed, and I call for a motion to adjourn.
So move, Mr. Chair.
Okay. Meeting adjourned at 12:25. Thank you, folks.
Good
Thanks,
meeting.
Eric.